Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Looking out the window, that's a paddling. Staring at my handles, that's a paddling.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sun Sphere Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I am Will, Threats of Self-Destruction Heim, with Ben, my B1s will blot out the sun, Fowler, Ryan, Space Alpaca Farmer Slowoski, and Tim, Blizzard Force next door to the Blizzard, Hannon. How are we doing this week?
I have no snow. I'm great. Yeah, I'm still good.
Yeah, we were really talking about how you were going to get buried in snow last week.
Yeah,
and then
yeah. I was hoping
we were all disappointed.
Didn't happen. Yeah, Buffalo got it, but we're fine.
Now, we feel for the people of Buffalo, our hearts and minds.
It's true. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes. And we wish Tim was in the same situation.
Yes. It was crazy. They got 6 feet, 7 feet, and we had a dusting, and we're only 45 to an hour away. So weather's crazy, man.
I heard it was taller than the actual quarterback for the Buffalo Bills.
Yeah.
The quarterback. Yes.
Yes.
I mean, if it was 7 foot of snow, it's taller than most people, but yes.
Yes.
I think it was like 78
But on
inches,
the field,
like,
on the football field, it was
Hold
taller
on.
Than the football player.
Are we really that starved for content that we're talking about weather?
Yeah, so I was about to make a yes. joke that, you know,
Listen,
usually we talk about the weather after the traffic, but you
Right,
know.
Yeah.
Top of the hour with STABcast. We're
If only someone had a thing that they were supposed to say now.
Yes. On the 110th episode of the STABcast, battle reports from all the other guys, and then one from me from a tournament, some listener emails, a little bit of news, and a whole bunch of other great things. Ben, tell me all about your great times. You almost did.
He nearly read it. I was kind of impressed. I could hear it on the tip of his tongue.
Yep.
So a little behind the scenes magic here. Will typed the very classic line from Anchorman, you know, that Ron Burgundy will read anything that comes on the teleprompter.
It's true.
Will went ahead and just typed that out, and Tim came awfully close to reading it. So.
I heard the but G, and I was like, no, not he won't really do it.
No. Well, there's a temptation, though. I read it, and then there's a temptation.
So speaking of doing things completely out of order, traditionally, the letter comes in much later in this episode.
It's true.
But I have to shout out Jan Philippe again, because he sent us a list like last Wednesday before our tournament.
Right.
I did not read the list when making my own list, and it turns out he and I are two great minds thinking alike, sir. He sent me a list that was basically 13 activations. How bad could it possibly be? It's
you.
All the B1 battle droids, you know, three stabs, two link targeting arrays and HQs, a battle tank. Now, Jan Philippe decided to go with just the high energy shells and a link targeting array on it. He was trying to find some more points there. I decided, you know what? I don't need the link targeting array. It's nice to have, but you know, those red dice hit pretty often. So I took the extra points and just put on the armor piercing shells. Because, you know, you may find something that needs some extra impact.
Yeah, you might never know.
The double shell will always get me salty.
I was going to say, those shells are just really good, so, you know, you can always just throw them in there.
They're,
it's fine.
They're really good when I can always shoot with one of them because the other one's refreshing that turn.
Salt.
So much salt.
I'm the one that's supposed to be salty against the CIS.
My saber tank is
sad. I'm running 797, 13 activations, which means I don't have the bid that I traditionally like.
Oh, no.
And guess what, guys? I was blue player the entire time anyway.
Screw you.
What?
I love
what
it.
Even happened? Now,
I love
Since
it.
I'm playing the Invasion Force, I did bring Mechanized Incursion, AI Coordination, Orbital Strike, Unrelenting Assault, the Roger Rogers, and the Unstoppable Advances. So I did bring all the cards you could.
All the special cards.
I didn't ever have to use Unstoppable Advance. So,
but it's so
nice.
But it's so good.
It's a good card. Yeah. Didn't have to use it at all. So we just never got to the place where it was like, well, let's move right fast. Cause I didn't have to. You know.
But if you did,
because you would have been able to. With 13 activations, triple stabs. So.
Yeah. I had rollout, major offensive, long march, disarray. I did change out some. I went to add the disarray because with this list, that stabs can be in a corner. I don't care.
Sure. Yeah.
Key positions. Ryan did convince me to add bombing run back in. We kind of had that conversation. Breakthrough just because stab riders are like, wee! And tanks, you know what? You know, if you just got to be like, shoot and move my big old base, let's move.
It's on most deployments, it's like two, maybe three moves to be able to drop the bomb.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Intercept transmissions, because I do like it. Especially because the tank can sit on top of one and intercept. Limited viz, fortified positions, minefield, and hostile, because I love fortified. It can't
intercept transmissions.
It can't, but it can sit on top of things, makes it hard for you to get close. Well, you got to walk around that tank.
You can't sit on top of it. You can sit in front of it, but yeah.
Yes. You can sit, well, that's going to come up later. That's going to come up later. Yeah, so like I said, good battle deck. I thoroughly enjoyed myself. Will, what nonsense did you play?
You know, sometimes you finish a model on Thursday night and say, you know, I should really play this on Saturday. And so you make a terrible rebel list and you just try to have fun. So I was running the event and, you know, I feel like there's a little bit of a bad vibe if you win your own event. So
yeah, you don't want to come too hard in adventure running.
Right. You don't want to stand there at the top of the at the end of the day and say, thank you all for coming. I'm the winner. I will take this gift card and this cool model.
We knew
and
Michael Henry was coming. We knew that wasn't going to happen.
Yes, but I wanted to make sure even harder. So okay. I played
Got it.
I played 10 activation rebels. I had Lando.
I know that sounds disappointing after I talked about my 13x, but 10x is about right.
Yeah, no, 10x I think is where the game is probably at its best. 13 is degenerate.
Yes, I would agree.
Anyway, I had Lando with underworld connections and a scanner, so he can do something if there's nothing else going on.
Scanner's an interesting call, but I can get behind it.
Putting some dodges on troopers, you know, or perhaps these other characters. I had IG-11. With okay. Bounty programming Hunter and E-Stims.
All okay. Right.
Then I had the Mando with comms relay, jetpack, flamer, and rifle.
Oh, you want the rifle route.
Right. I did. We'll talk about it. For core, I had a full 6 core. I had two vets with CMOs, two Mark II blaster emplacements. A rebel trooper with an ion and a fleet trooper with a med bot. And
take it.
And then a measly little X-34 with just the A-300 rifle guy and the unstable R-5 astromech, for which I blame Floor.
So let me ask this. Why the unstable with just when you're just throwing 4 white dice?
So it can quad move.
Okay.
Oh, that makes sense.
Because IG is going to sit in it, and I could try to do like this quadruple move flanking thing to drop him off behind sure. their whole list.
I always forget that you can use unstable just to perform a move instead of an attack. Because yep. usually I just want to blow stuff up.
Right, and that's normally where it's best. But
yeah,
if you want to zoom around the whole board
sure.
and get IG-11 into a good spot for that one pip, try to blast as many out of cover shots as you can.
Yeah.
That's what was whispered into my ear by Floor of the Dwarf, that this could be a fun idea, was IG and the Landspeeder. He had a much better list around that concept than me, mainly because he had like two DLT trooper squads and then two pikes with Mando IG. So but his would probably do a lot better.
Yeah.
Oh, and yeah, and sure. he's also better than me, yes. So it's it is a silly list, but I had fun. I was running all 6 of IG and Mando's cards, and then my 3 contingency were Lando's 3 cards.
Sure.
So I did contingency a few times, and then I used the order 2 pip to get some free wombo combo things, you know, like you do with Lando.
As one does.
Like you do.
Yeah.
As you do. Now, but like you said, 10x, but that's still, to be fair, that's a pretty fat 10x.
I mean, it's three named characters, yeah.
It's 3 characters, 6 core.
Yeah.
It was fun.
I said that before, but my microphone disconnected, so that was fun. It's a good time.
Oh, fun.
That's why I was so quiet. So I got to ask the modeling question, Will, since you're talking about these things.
Uh-huh.
Could you mod the Lando Calrissian model that we currently have into a Grief Karga?
Ooh, that'd be cool.
Potentially, but then
I haven't built mine yet, but I'm saying you've got basically all that except, I guess, the actual Rebels part of that. But
right,
you know, land speeders, IG-11, you know, Din, just kind of running around doing stuff.
Right, yeah. No, I enjoy the model as it is, being Lando with the magic cape.
So I've been playing for the past couple weeks, if you've been listening. I've been trying to make Din, Cassian, and something kind of work. And I kind of settled on double Wookiee, and it was okay. I think it's a good list, but it's not It's not a me list. I never felt like I had control over objectives. I felt I was really good at just kind of fighting, and if I came up against a list that had answers to deal with my big melee threats, then I just kind of lost because I had a really difficult time striking back and actually playing whatever objectives came down. So I looked at what I knew was going to be kind of coming out from what a lot of our locals are playing, and I went back to my Gen Con list of Echo Base Tripletons, and I decided to cut R2-D2 to bring it down to 11 activations because I knew with Din and IGs running around, Bounty was going to be everywhere. And in a list with no vehicles for Rebels, R2 was just a bounty kind of waiting to happen. He didn't really serve a purpose other than try to score secret mission. And I typically don't want to run my bounty target towards the bounty hunters. So, what?
No,
so I dropped R2 and I dropped my comms off of my Tons to get 3 CMOs and cut my bid a little bit, but I still had an 11-point bid. So it's 11 activations instead of 12, 3 Tons, an FD laser cannon with a generator, 3 vets with CMOs, 3 Mark IIs, and Princess Leia helming the thing. And yeah, I got to play a bunch of objectives that nobody else really wanted to play, and I felt like that list gave me a lot more control during turn zero of making opponents play my game, which is what I really like to do. So I'm a degenerate and brought Tripletons.
You are.
It is known.
It is well known.
It is very, very, very much known. But you know, well known. In the end, I'm running stabs that have agile. You're, mm-hmm. You know, you walk and grab some tokens. You're running those Tauntauns, which are going to walk and grab some tokens. But wouldn't it be cool if we just fought a bunch of lists that just had tokens?
Like, yeah, let's start. Just I like, mean, I'm lucky I only had to play one Shadow Collective list, but we'll get there.
Oh. Air quotes, lucky.
Yeah.
I mean, listen, do your Tons have outmaneuver?
My
staff does not have outmaneuver.
For 6 points, they do.
I've run that.
Yeah.
It's
I would
actually,
run it now, but yeah. Nope. Yeah.
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah.
But okay.
No, got to so put Tim, up close on those Tons. Got to put up close.
Stabcast North, you did not play in a tournament this past episode, but you did play a game. So what list were you running on your game?
I did. I've actually been fairly busy with moving things and family things, so I've only gotten one game in since the last time we talked, but it was a quite good one. It was a really good practice game, honestly, for PAX. I really, really needed it. And I got to play double IG versus double IG, which was a very, again, interesting game. It is a game I needed to play. So at the time, I had 11 act, triple do, IG-11 and 88. Obviously, they both had comms relay on them. I think I had tenacity and such on the thing. Hunter on 11, stuff like that. And then a bunch of naked core, more or less naked core. I had a couple of pikes with the capels on them to help if I needed a Courage 2 objective squad.
Sure.
But yeah, 11, 796, so nothing crazy bid-wise. I kind of changed it around to get 11 in there. I had been, if you remember from last time we talked, I was running IG-88 and Cad Bane, so I wanted to see, mm-hmm. like, what's it like to run both of them. Heard a lot of hate on IG-11, which I don't think is warranted. I think he's
solid.
He's tricky. He's definitely tricky. He's not nearly as easy as 88 is, but I think he's still good. I think double IG has absolutely got some merit. But the other double IG I faced was pretty different, which again was good, as much as the semi-mirror could be different. For as naked as my core were, his core were dummy thick, I believe is a scientific term. He had 2 shores with the heavies, which I feel like is such a rarity now because the heavy is so damn expensive. Yeah. 2 shores with the heavy, 2 mortars, a heavy capo pike, so pike with capo and the long gun, Dell and a stormtrooper unit, and then 2 snipers, and then of course both IG and then the obligatory officer like we both had with underworld connections because legally we must do this. Interesting, both his IGs had hunter and e-stims and no comms relay, which again, interesting.
Interesting.
In the e-stim, I've seen it discussed, so this is not like a new concept to me, but it was new to see it in person. E-stims with IG-88's one pip, which is like the I'm not going to die card, like I'm not going to die until the end of the round, is absolutely fascinating. And we played KP, Major Offensive, Fortified, so pretty standard. It was a good map. We probably should have moved some line-of-sight blockers around because the middle of that map was a little bit open, but the barricades helped with that a little bit. So at least it was we couldn't hide. But I tell you what, like those heavy squads, I felt them. He started farther back than I did, so I started right by the middle point as much as I could with Major. And then he started in the almost like the middle of his deployment because of my dewbacks, which I think was a fair call. And my dewbacks, man, they just died. Like, end of round two, all three were dead.
Oof.
And they could not roll. No blocks. So it was his every shot he took, whether it was the shores or the pikes, it was all but one was a hit or a crit. And like, yeah, you got armor one, but whoop-de-doo. Okay, so you take one away. So it's still like I was rolling six multiple times. I think I had to roll six defense four times in a row, something like that. And it was, it was just rough. So all the dewbacks died, but. Remember, this is KP, so we are playing objectives.
Sure. Right.
And so that kind of was my plan. Like, that was my intention was for them to die. However, I will say they died a turn too soon. They did not quite get to the enemy. They got a couple shots off, but they never really got to be engaged.
Not to go do what dudes do.
Correct, which was a little bit sad. And that was also a learning curve on my part, even though I've played dudes a bunch. I was not used to someone who would stay so far back. And so basically, turn one, I had the option to double spur, and I only spurred once. And had I double spurred, probably two of those three dewbacks would have gotten into melee. Because then my second round, double spur, was just shy of being able to get into melee. So yeah, so interesting learning curve there. So moral of that story is, if you're going to bum rush a gun line with your dewbacks or any kind of melee unit, then rush the gun line. Don't just kind of dance around it, like run it, especially if there's no line of sight blockers. They had no line of sight blocking that they could hide behind, so they just had to run across a not open field, they're barricades, but creature troopers don't care about barricades, right. So they had to run across and they didn't make it, but all that to say,
so let me ask the question.
Okay, yes, go ahead.
You've got double IGs, both with like range four, pretty solid weapons. Did you have to bum rush with your dudes? Or could you have held them back? And when he pushed for his KP,
he had a gun line. I lose.
So they're always going to sit out and just.
If I sit at range four and he sits at range four, I lose automatically. So I have to do something.
I mean, let me ask you.
Sure, because if you're just trading, he only had two T21s, right?
Two and a heavy capo. I don't. Yeah, you have to rush that. Like it. Yeah, I don't have any heavies. That's the problem. So anyway, so what were you?
So Tim, you played dudes lots more than I have. Yeah. I played against you while playing dudes.
Yes,
I know the biggest fear with the double spurring early like that is if you get shot a couple times, then you panic a deuce.
Right.
Yes, which is why I run endurance on them, and I will not run a dewback without endurance. That is just I don't care what people say. I will not run it without endurance because I've had them panic before. And I think if you're not sparring with them, you're not really getting your full value normally, unless you're really trying to like use line of sight blocking or something like that. So it was definitely my concern, which then ironically they got so much suppression because of the two mortars and everything else anyway, they just ended up dying anyway. So it kind of half dozen or the other, but I should have just double spurred, but it's okay.
I mean, I love a dewback, but you know, that has always been the biggest flaw with them is that they will panic pretty quick.
Sure.
Because you have to use their spur to get them farther.
Right. Well, and that's why Vader dudes is so good, especially Commander Vader, because then you don't have to worry about panicking. You'll be restricted, but not dead, which is nice.
Right.
But anyway, and the nice thing, too, is like with a creature trooper, you know, you can withdraw if you need to withdraw, and you still get a free action doing that at least. You can't get a free one if you panic, but, you know, I don't know. Right. I like having creature troopers. Anyway. There's pluses and minuses for how little cover they get, but also all the cool things they can do.
Yeah, anyway, I feel that.
So they all died, but they were able to slow him down enough, which was the intention, And so that because he had a gun line and they had like these kind of guys that were running out in front of him, like, oh, shoot me. And if you don't shoot me, I'm going to chomp your face off. And so I was able to do that and get everybody else into position, which mainly was my whole army behind the line of sight blocking. And then both IGs kind of held back for a little bit and let him move up. And then, long story short, was both IG-11s getting their pot shots off. He went, interesting too, he went the suppressive route with his IG-11. I went the pierce route. So his range 4 shot was suppressive. My range 4 shot was pierce 1. They both did really well. Like, I think both did what they were intending to do. So he put a lot of suppression down that probably would have panicked me, but I got some lucky rolls. And then my pierce did a lot of work to stopping him from touching the point. So I think they both did great. So that was one, another interesting lesson was IG-11 versus IG-11. Neither one of us wanted to kind of rush in. And then his 88 moved up, and my 88, I moved mine up so I could get some shots on him. And I killed one of his mortars, hooray. And then this is where it gets interesting. So we had both at this point already played our one pip, which is the, again, I'm not going to die till the end of the turn.
Right.
And he, I got to make sure I get my order right. The turn that this happened, I think it was turn 3, he killed my IG-88, but before mine had gone, so I still got to go.
So
it was like, hey, I'm going to die. There's no doubt here. I'm going down, but I'm going to take you with me.
That ability's a pain in the neck.
Yeah. Well, and then so the interesting debate that I hadn't even thought about was, if you're going to die, you don't care about bounty. So then do I shoot the 88 that shot me? Because if I get bounty, I don't care. But then I realized he's going to get my bounty because he was the one that did the shot. And so like I have to try and deny the bounty. So it was this weird like denial game. But again, yeah. It was a very cool interaction that I haven't really had to think about before. So yeah, so I did an arsenal shot back at him and I had the high ground. So it helped me a little bit positioning wise. And I got a good roll into him and he got like, I think he had 3 wounds left. So I got a few wounds through. And then honestly, all that happened after that was, so my IG went down, and then his, one of my storm squads poked out, or a couple of my storm squads poked out naked and just threw a whole bunch of dice, and just the weight of dice, he took a couple more wounds, but he had already gone, remember? So then he put those wounds on the E-Stims card, and then so he got to go again next round because of the E-Stims and the other card, and then he died at the end of that round. It was just a weird, like, you kill me, but not yet. It's very fascinating how that works. And then basically, just to make a long story short, I killed him, so he dropped, quote-unquote, dropped that bounty. I didn't get a bounty. Both IG-11s lived happily ever after. They just stayed back and took their range 4 shots, which they were both kind of denial pieces, because like, if you get too close to me, I'll pop off and do my close range things.
Yeah, do that card.
Yeah. So it was just interesting. And so that I was just able to win on the point because I just had more bodies touching the point because I was able to thin it out and let him come to me at that point. But those Dubecks in the front end really had to die. They just died too soon. But they really had to die to be the screen. But I will say his list was also 11 acts. He was 795. So he had the bid by one point. And it was terrifying. Like those heavies hit like trucks. Oh my God. So it's definitely inspired me to look at my list and change it around a little bit. But yeah, long story short, double IG versus double IG gets messy, but a lot of fun. Super close. Super, super close. I had some crazy rally rolls.
This episode does come out before PAX. Are you willing to put out what could be your PAX list?
It comes out before PAX, but after PAX, lists after are locked list in.
Submission, yeah.
Yeah, so it doesn't matter. So yes, so that's true. It's a good point, Ben. Thank you for saying that. That's a good point. Yeah.
Because you're the only one going to PAX. Like yeah, we're playing local tournaments. Like we're beating up hillbillies. In
went
the
down.
We are so good at this. So
I made the hard choice to go down to 10 acts and only one bounty hunter. So I only do IG-88.
Ooh,
yeah, IG-88, okay. Triple do still because that was my main bounty was that I wanted IG-88 and triple dues. And then it's going to be a shore trooper with a heavy and an officer because of the points working out where I just had like that odd amount of points left. Two capo heavy pike squads, stormtrooper Dell, because that's really great with IG-88 because they can both hang back and Dell can be like, hey, I got you, buddy. Take those two wounds off because his did that as well.
Sure.
And that's actually happened to me twice now that I faced IG-88. Del has, or either a Del or a repair bot has fixed him. And so, yes, I took those wounds off. And then, yeah, it takes me down to 10. Just regular officer, naked officer. 796. So I'll still have a 4-point bid, which sometimes is enough. So yeah, we'll see how it goes. I'm a little bit nervous about going down from 2 bounties down to 1. But I think the meat it brings with me, because again, this game that I just talked about worked out where I had a lot of cover for my core, mm-hmm. even though the Dubacks didn't have it, but the core had lots of cover, so they were able to survive. But if we were on a slightly different map, I think it's a different story, and then I think his heavies start getting some shots on my core, and I just lose on attrition. So
mm-hmm.
I kind of took that to heart, and I was like, I'd like heavies. I miss heavies on my core. I don't like naked core as much as I used to. It's a scary world. Dipoles being what they are, they can just beat you to death.
True.
Does it feel bad that the Pike Syndicates with the Disruptor and the Capo is cheaper than your Dubacks?
Yes.
Yes. Excellent. Next question.
Whenever I make these lists, I think I'm like, oh, man, if I could just bring all of this, I'll just be a Shadow Collective player at that point.
Yep.
How many times do I dance that line? Like, oh man, if I just change like a couple of these things around, I've just made a really effective Shadow Collective list.
Mine are locked away in the box over there. I dare not.
Waiting for the points update, maybe? Question mark.
Yeah.
Waiting for the points update, so I can play them without being a dick.
Without being a dick, yeah.
Yes, exactly. Yes, exactly. Exactly. But yeah, so we'll see how it goes. Again, I'm nervous about it. I think it'll put up a good fight. Don't get me wrong, but
sure.
I was tempted to bring triple bikes instead of triple dues, but
they're good.
I just like Dubacks more. Good. I'm not saying that Dubacks are better than bikes by any stretch. I personally favor them more. They're more fun. That's it.
You have more practice with them as well.
Sure, we can't.
That's fair. That's fair.
I love as we talk about this points update, it's like now we're talking about the second coming.
Right.
It can either be Tuesday or a thousand years from now.
Yeah, yeah, you know, who knows?
One day.
How did you read the sacred text?
The apocryphal points update. Like
it could be anywhere. So, Will, you decided to host our event. I greatly appreciate that.
Yep,
I did. I bit the bullet and told Walt, our store manager, that I would run the event. I posted up things. I invited people. And, you know, I'm really glad that we got 16 people. That's a really good turnout.
Yeah, I did.
Ben has written in for me to give him a shout out for working like a rented mule. He did go alone Friday night and set up all his tables. I'm very thankful for that.
I hauled all the tables I owned in my house in my vehicle out to the store and got most of them set up.
Yeah.
I only had two tables I'd not done by 10 o'clock. The store owner let me stay a little late because he was just doing paperwork and boxing things for internet sales. So I was like, yeah, you can keep setting up. It's like, thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, that's why I tried to pack up most of the tables after the end of the event.
Yeah. I do appreciate
that. But yeah, 16 people. It was a great turnout. Lots of people for their first tournament ever. You know, lots of Wednesday folk had never had a tournament. So. And it was good to meet them. A lot of them I had never met because I haven't been able to do Wednesdays with my new job and things.
So I'm sorry, it was I good didn't to meet fly down for the local. It's very sad. Yeah, very sad to miss it.
You
it's very selfish.
You
of
could
me,
have.
Clearly.
You could have been the odd man out and gotten a bye. Continue your winning streak.
Now,
yeah, it was a great
credit,
event.
He did not come out Friday night to help me because he got off work at like 7:45.
I didn't know the store would let us stay late because normally they close at 9 and kick everyone out. It's like it takes me half an hour. So I told Ben, I was like, I can show up at 8:30 and say great job and then leave with you.
Like honestly, my watch has stopped working, so I'm just working. I'm just doing things. And at some point, I reach for my cell phone. I'm like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. It's 9:30. Why don't you kick me out? I was like, I got nothing. I'm working here, so it's fine.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, well, I appreciate it. So he let me stay until I was done. So at that point, I've been up since 5 o'clock, so I was done by.
So I brought the people donuts, and I generated the first round.
It's true.
Ben, who did you end up facing?
I got to fight Scott.
Ooh.
So I love fighting. I love playing Scott. I love playing Scott these tournaments. He always brings something interesting. And he and I are just chatty Cathys.
Yes.
I'll be honest, there was a solid debate as to whether or not we would get past round two.
I did not think y'all would. Don't be real honest.
We got to the end of round four before the timer.
Hey.
Then we decided at that point the game was clearly heading in a particular direction. So Scott was running Lando and Wookiees and three naked troopers and R2-D2 and an X-34.
Hell
and
yeah.
Din and two sets of pikes.
Okay, I'm just going to jump in for a second. There were four, technically five Rebel players. Ryan was running the Blizzard, Echo or not Base. Blizzard, whatever, Snow Force.
Yeah, the other, the bad guys.
Snow Force, I like
other
that.
Snow
I
friends.
Like, the bad guys, Blizzard Force, yes.
Yeah, good guys, Snow friends. And so the event counted it as four Rebel players. Three of us had an X-34.
Yes, there are a lot of X-34s out there.
Yeah, and I think all of us had Din. So it was really just an excuse to play Din was the Rebel faction that day.
So how did the Rebels do? Did the Rebels win the whole event? Yes?
The Rebels as a faction, again without Ryan, went 2-8.
Oh, okay.
On the day.
Yeah. So the bad guys lost. Tim.
Clearly, yeah. Rebels, clearly Rebels are hurting and they need to be buffed just out
there. Yes, that's the takeaway.
Yep, I mean, that's the takeaway. 2-8's real bad.
Don't well, look at know, the, or, don't look at the sure, Echo Base. Yeah,
don't look
record.
At who played yep. what and what they played, or you know.
Yeah,
fine.
Don't look at these like yeah. Scott and I both running Rebels for like the first time in a long time.
Data you points. Know, don't look at any data points.
No, look at this raw, in a vacuum.
Just the final the results. Fine. All that matters. That's right.
Sorry, Ben. Go ahead.
So we are playing on the icy planet that that Mr. Appleton let us borrow lowly 6 months ago. Tim was supposed to bring him back with him when he like sold his house and moved north, but then he forgot. He didn't do it, so
I forgot a lot of things so, yeah. down south. So, sorry, mostly my dignity. Yeah, but.
You did. Yes. So we're playing on that icy planet. I've rearranged some pieces there after some feedback at our last tournament using it, and so we are playing key positions: Long March and Fortified, because I love me some Long March. Scott did not want me to be as close to the center point because we're playing key positions.
Sure,
you know, it's Long March, so I got there pretty quick.
Mm-hmm.
Problem is, Scott got a little aggressive here and ran a Wookiee out towards the center. Key did not make it to the center point.
No, Wookiee's died.
He was gunned down.
He was gunned down hard. You know, there's a really nice new card that allows you to pull what the Empire used to do, which is, hey, I've got an aim and spent it. Do you want that aim? I'll take that aim, buddy. Appreciates it. And so I just gunline that right down the middle. Pop, 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 pop. As we're starting to have that kind of battle clear up, the Staps are coming around the corner. They're flanking. They're shooting units. I'm just trying to prevent him from running towards the center because at some point I'm planning on using that 3-pip to advance all my dudes forward and just run towards the center and just mob it because I've got 8 sets of B1s plus 3 Staps plus a tank that's just long-range shooting at some stuff. And I still have my T-Series man's going to like pop. So he realizes Din's going to get shot to pieces if he steps around a corner. So he's going to try to hold Din, just kind of shoot some edges, kind of line of sight, block. He decides, I've got to go throw R2-D2. So the X-34 comes screaming around the corner. I attempt to kill the X-34 in a single round. I somehow don't.
Yes.
I get very close.
It happens. You'd be surprised.
It does happen.
That's cost me games.
R2-D2 pops out. I actually shoot R2-D2 as he's in the thing. He's like, you know, he's sitting there. Might as well shoot him first. Heavy cover. He's going to have heavy cover no matter what we do. So let's see if we can't get lucky with a tank shot. We don't quite make it. Don't actually kill him in that shot, but we did try very hard. And then, so now I've got to chase R2-D2 because if he gets to that point, and we're playing key position, so I can take two. I won't take his point, so I won't grab three of them. So then it comes down to kill points. And I have B1s, which are not a lot of points, but there is a chance that, you know, Din just starts cleaning up units that have one or two models left in it, and I can't have that happen to me. So I go after R2-D2 hard, also because I hate R2-D2.
Good, as you should.
See, the right call, absolutely. You know,
the great thing about R2-D2 when he's that far away, because we're playing Long March, his other units are not close enough for me to shoot at, and there's some line of sight blocking things, so I have all the free reign to shoot R2-D2 when I want to. He does contingency into a blast off to make him just run away faster, to find a hiding spot on my side of the board, but we do knock him down pretty hard. I had to bring my Staps in to kind of clean the thing up, unfortunately, but that just means that I still have 8 sets of B1s and a tank just maneuvering towards the centerpiece. So as we get to the end of round 4, Scott has tried to survive it pretty hard, but he's lost a lot of units, bled a lot of pieces. Turns out 13 activations is real good, Jean-Philippe.
Who would have thought?
It's like, oh, look,
who would have thought?
You did all the things you wanted. I still have 5 activations left because I've cleared
it's
2.
So good.
I, for one, am shocked.
So good. I don't want to give up my 11.
End of round 4 happens. Scott and I look at each other about throwing down some command cards. He's like, we don't have that much time left, and we see where this is headed. So we shake hands, having had a wonderful conversation about life, the pursuit of happiness, Legion, all the fun things. Plus, Scott's always a great painter, so we have lots of fun. He's actually, I think, trying to, not to spoil any news for you, he does a lot of modeling. We've talked about his modeling to do some robotics and some mechanization pieces. I think he may be putting together like a YouTube series, so be on the lookout for that. Once he's officially headed up, we'll throw some links out there, because the stuff he does with the models is always delightful. So, yeah, basically R2-D2 dies, so there's no secret mission. I'd lost like a unit of staps, a B1 model or two, but never concentrated enough to actually lose entire activation. So, you know, when you add activate, you get the things, you shoot all the dice. White dice are white dice, which means sometimes it'll be blank, but sometimes it'll be just full of crits. So, mm-hmm. You know, we just love those things.
Why did you bully that old man?
Scott... You're going to have to cut that. That's exactly what I did. I had lots of fun. Will, who'd you get to play? Because this is a room full of new faces.
It is.
And I played a guy I play often. So
as is your fate.
It is my fate.
Round one, I drew Blake from Nashville. He was a new face.
Nashville?
I had not spoken to him. Scene. Apparently he'd been talking to Ryan in the Tennessee gaming group kind of Facebook.
Yep.
Okay. But it was good to meet him. We both lamented the lack of Nashville Legion spaces. It's like the Game Cave exists, yes, but no one plays there. Like, oh, so Nashville, get it together.
Like, the Game Cave,
I know there's players out there.
There's players in Murfreesboro looking for games. They never can find each other. I don't know if they all play in North Nashville, which means no one hears of them.
We talked about it, and it's we've run into the issue with Knoxville where people don't want to cross town. Nashville has an actual excuse where it takes 90 minutes to cross town.
Yeah,
for sure. It does. The traffic is just awful. The construction is awful.
If there's, you know, 7 or 8 people that play Legion, but they're all sprinkled around Nashville, it's like, well, there is no place for them to all meet that's easy to get to. So I get it, but it is lamentable.
Price of real estate, it's hard to own a game store in Nashville.
True, yeah.
Outer for sure.
Oh, yeah. He was playing some Corset Rebels. It was like, I think it was 4 Rebel Trooper units with Z6s plus a Pike unit. Then he had 2 AT-RTs with rotaries. He had Mando and Cassian and K2. So it was,
I'm here for it. I dig it. Yeah, a little bit of everything. Yeah.
Yeah. And we ended up on Disarray, Intercept, and I think Clear? No, Hostile Environment. Sorry. It just didn't come up much. Because it was just a murder fight.
Hard to have suppression when you're dead.
Yeah, the disarray points, or, you know, disarray corners. My far corner, I just put IG in the land speeder. Then my other corner was just everything else.
Gross. Yeah.
Then directly across from my everything corner, he put everything except 2 AT-RTs on the other corner. And then 2 Rebel Trooper squads out there to try to, like, get to that intercept point that's way off over there. So basically IG ended up controlling that point by murdering those Rebel Troopers in melee. Like, we took some pot shots, but I just couldn't get through, so I was like, fine, I won't shoot them, I'll just punch them to death. And it works pretty well.
Yeah, especially, absolutely it does.
Especially since his melee weapon also gains pierce with the bounty thing.
Yeah, it sure does.
Because all weapons gain pierce one.
I've not played my IG yet, but I do, like, when I look at him, I don't know what to put in that training slot. I think there's a handful of, like, decent options.
Mm-hmm.
Part of me is like, do I just taxi him over and put tenacity on him and let's have a good time?
I mean, it's a Chewbacca die pool, the overpower for red.
Yeah. Well, with pierce, yeah, absolutely.
Right, yeah.
Anyway, it's spooky. That seems like a good use of IG. A different use, but still a good one.
Right. So he was over there holding the far point. Then the middle was kind of empty. Like, he put his AT-RTs in that kind of area to try to range me away from it. So the first scoring round, no one was there.
Wow.
I could have.
That's pretty rare, actually.
I could have double moved, but then he still had both.
Tennessee Legion.
Right. So the middle was empty, and then the other point is just a murder spree. We're using Ryan's crate table, and the intercept point we're scoring is on top of Ryan's giant rock mound thing that you've had made.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we're all just clustered around this thing and, like, coming around the corner and taking shots and getting shot, and it's just craziness. Troopers are dying left and right.
his Mando comes around because he's bountied Lando. Because he sees White Save and says, I can probably kill that one. Meanwhile, I've bountied Cassian and his Mando rather than K2. And I get one of my bounties. But his Mando comes around, gets some shots off, but Lando magic capes away. And then,
he does.
And then the rest of my... what was left just opened fire, killed Mando. Although he did roll a lot of saves. But eventually got through the dice. Then my Mando jumps on top of the giant rock, shoots down into Cassian. Madness is happening. It was just an onslaught of death and destruction. But by the end, my Mando's dead, his Mando's dead, Cassian is dead, all of our core are dead, apart from a few spare Rebel vets that are holding that point for me.
So it's the end of Saving Private Ryan.
Yeah, really.
Oh,
Cassian died because my Mando jumped off the rock into a melee punch. Like, Mando dove right into Cassian and hit him with the butt end of a rifle, but then K2 shot him up to death. It was a whole thing. But after the orgy of death and IG just kind of standing in the far corner going, I want to get involved, but I also want to score. I did pull it out with just some more core surviving and Lando and others keeping that scoring. So I was up 7-2 by the end on intercept.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
It was really close a few rounds, and then the final double score, I got the 2-1 and just
And double ATRT is tough into intercept.
Yeah.
If you've got a handful of your big activations that can't score.
Yep.
So
but he did use them well as kind of denial pieces for that middle point, like I said. But
sure, for sure.
Eventually, my Ion guys got a lucky shot off that did like 3 wounds. And then since it was Ion, we were able to run around behind it to get that scoring point, do stuff like that. So, but a good game. A good game for round one. A victory for my weird rebel list.
Huzzah.
Ryan, what did you draw?
So I drew Mitch, who I've gotten to play pretty regularly, about once a month.
I did hear a lot of groans about round one pairings, about Wednesday players having already faced each other a bunch of times.
There were a lot of players who had like played each other in the last 2 weeks, but that's just fine. I always do enjoy playing with Mitch. He's a really thoughtful player. He's, you know, when I was absent, he kind of filled the role of like pushing the Knoxville Rebel meta, and he's been big on the bounty hunters lately.
And he's brought, beaten you the last 2 podcasts, right? Like you've talked about Mitch games the last 2.
I beat him once. I diced him off the table, and we were just along for the ride with the dice game. And then the time before we played, he did beat me in a pretty solid game. So we definitely trade games back and forth. But Mitch brought Din IG, a rebel officer with, you know, Underworld, obviously, 2 vets, 2 Mark IIs, 2 snipers, and an X-34, and which is a spooky list. Like, it's a list that can do a lot of different things. It's got a little mini gun line with 2 CMOs. It's got some snipers. It's got some aggressive bounty hunters with a land speeder to move them up. And he just gets the worst turn zero. It's the turn zero. I'm blue. I got a huge bid. It's the turn zero that you know, as a Tawn player, you dream for, where he's either got to play as red, payload hemmed in, or he can get rid of hemmed in, and we play bombing run, because he either basically had to pick his poison, whether he wanted to get rid of hemmed in or whether he wanted to get rid of bombing run, and that's a tough choice against my list. Out of curiosity, what do you guys pick there? Do you play payload on hemmed in, or do you play bombing run against triple tons?
I play probably hemmed in. I play
payload on payload. Hemmed in.
Sorry, yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah,
payload. As red?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Ooh, that's a tough game.
Payload
is that's on hemmed easier than
bombing run with tons. Yep. To get the thing. Nah,
exactly.
You're not gonna win that.
Exactly.
I would go bombing run. I've got a speeder and Mando speed 3. Like,
I mean, yeah, it depends on
your. Do you need bodies to pick up that bomb when they drop in the right spot? Do you have the activation count? Like.
Yeah. We'd be at 10 each. It would be a game.
It was tough.
I guess it depends if I have something that can also score bombing run. That depends. Right. Like my current list, I would run bombing run.
He had, right. I mean, he had a speeder and he had two bounty hunters. So his choice during turn zero was, do I put IG in the speeder or do I give him a bomb with, you know, he's reasonably quick. He doesn't lose actions to suppression and he's got a red save with armor. Or do I throw just a bomb on the speeder and then put IG in and run forward? Which is what he elected to do. He gave his third bomb and we both knew it was shaky ground. But he was hoping to win the gunfight early and he passed it to a strike team.
Oh, no. No.
So, well, I mean, what were his other options?
The first one you mentioned, where you give it to the robot and make him walk in.
Yeah. Well, that was the option he chose not to do. But I do think that we talked about that. I do think that is the right play. So he dives with the speeder, triple moving on the first turn. Din goes pretty passive, but I still managed to squeeze some standby tokens and some CMO shots into him and just kind of pepper him. I don't get any wounds. Din's defense dice are amazing. I get a tricky fire support up into a sniper with, you know, the me being able to him scouting a little too far forward and me using detachment to get a CMO close. And then having a taunt, I think, start the fire support. But he rolls an absurd. It was like a 3 for 4 on the saves when I just needed two blanks because I could see both minis. It was rough. Dice go all Mitch's way for the first two turns. I take some big hits on the nose. I get a little bit of chip damage into the speeder, but not much. Mando saves everything. Strike team save everything. And I've obviously got a very good position because I'm playing really passive with my taunts to be able to kind of... I'm running away from his bounty hunter so he can't really engage me, and I want to just have the taunts deliver the bombs and clean up his back line and try to win on points destroyed while he runs bounty hunters and a speeder into 4 emplacement troopers and 3 CMOs. And as that kind of starts to happen, I keep putting, like, I position probably about half my army because he splits his X-34 and Din to kind of make a pincer maneuver. And I just pivot 2 emplacements and 2 CMOs to just pepper Din on the approach. And I am forcing save after save after save after save after save. And he just blocks it all. And I was getting mad and I was getting a little frustrated. But at the top of turn 3, he can't order Din because he's got to play the IG, I shoot everybody card. And I want to say he gets 5 shots with IG's 1 pip and does quite a bit of damage. I managed to get the speeder, which actually may have been a bad thing because then it gave IG a wound, but also let him put him in base-to-base with the speeder wherever he wanted to go, which meant he had a little bit of wiggle room to get the perfect range on IG's 1 pip to make sure as many units were at range 2 as possible. And I realize that's going to happen to me. I can't do anything about it. So I just throw everything I have into Din and Taunts just keep carrying bombs and being nuisances. Din takes no damage. Din is Mitch's last... I think he's taken 1 wound at this point.
Yeah, that's about how it goes. Either Din just dies like straight up or he just is invincible. Yeah. Boba too.
But the one thing that went my way... Well, 2 things. But the first thing that went my way is Din could not come out of that bag. Because he played an IG card, IG's order was already out. So that means there's only 1 operative in the bag, and it's Mitch's last token to come out. What that means is his barely wounded Din is suppressed to hell and back. I want to say he's got 8 suppression on him. And I just, like I said, I'm peppering him with everything I have and just getting nothing to stick.
Yep.
But it's Din. He's courage 3. He can rally out of that. He'll probably only get a single action, but he's probably not going to panic and jetpack off the board and drop his bomb. And then he drops his bomb and panics off the board. Gross. So I felt a little bit of vindicated that I wasn't getting the wounds through, but at least the action economy was kind of back into swing where all the actions I put into Din did end up stopping him. So he loses on turn 3. The speeder, it did manage to drop its bomb, but I got the speeder. I made him drop the Din bomb, and then the sniper strike team was kind of running behind Din, doing its best to kind of hide the second man as best as he could. But I eventually got IG down because once Din was gone, my army had really nothing else to shoot at. The Taunts had gotten into his troopers and were tying the CMOs up. And by the end of turn four, he had dropped one bomb and gotten it to explode. I had dropped all three of mine and was moving to claim the one that Din had dropped. IG was gone, and he tried to call it, and I looked at Will, and I was like, Will, we're playing MOV, right? And I was the asshole. And I was like, no, I want to play the last two turns. And he kept playing a little while longer and then called it a table because it was going to happen. Yeah, yeah, I was a degenerate. I got a table round one. It was a tough turn zero, and I think Mitch did about as good as he could have out of that turn zero, but that's not what you want to see the cards flip.
So we all exit round one with a win.
Yeah, no yes, STABcast team kills round one. This is a miracle.
Not yet. So I generate the round two. Ben, woo, where do you end up?
I am playing a person I've never met before.
Whoa. Hooray, that's Aaron. New for you.
It's a first.
But we're playing on Fort Christmas, which is always a delight because I do love for Fort sure. Christmas. But I'm also going to play the new degeneracy, which is the Shadow Collective. All the nonsense. Except this wasn't, I guess it was the static nonsense. It was a CAD bus nonsense.
I have a Fort Christmas note before we start here. Round one, Michael Henry gets put on Fort Christmas, and he has about three different table questions for me about what stuff actually is. So thanks for letting me have that experience, Ben.
Yes.
Did you just look at him and say, did you discuss it with your opponent?
Well, he was asking if something was height one or height two because the berries could
oh, that's not the first time that question has been asked.
Or bend down to height one.
We had that question at Cherokee.
Yeah.
Yes.
I was like, height one, whatever.
Didn't even roll a die. You just made a thing.
Just like, majority of it's height one. Don't just, I was like, do I have some scissors? Let me just cut that little piece off. Like,
just bend it. It's a wire, man. It's a wired berry.
Yeah, but it kept popping back up, and he was confused. Anyway, back to your Fort Christmasing.
Keeping it PG-13.
Very vigorous berry.
So,
yes.
So Eric is playing CAD Bus Pike Gunline.
Boo.
It's 11 activations. It's 796. Black Sun Vigo. He's got Pike Syndicate Capos. He's got CAD Bane with stuff. He's got Black Sun Enforcers with scatter guns and four Pike Syndicates with the Disruptor Boys and an AA5 with the Gonk and the heavy laser.
Seems good.
So, you know, yeah, it's a lot of things, but it's only 11 activations and I've got 13.
Yeah. Yeah, there's no maul and there's not capos on the pikes. They're foot soldiers instead of capos. They are courage one, which is a pretty big deal.
They are, but you know they've got their own Vigos within close range. Like they're not too. They're not in a terrible spot. They're not
right. Yeah. For sure.
And the Vigos are always going to the capos are always gonna be back far enough where you don't have to really worry about them getting shot at.
But close enough to use aid and vigilance. Try to get as much range
for as possible. Exactly. So we're playing on fortified key positions and roll out. Honk, honk. Now, this is on Fort Christmas, which is kind of the way it was built this particular day. There's a kind of a centerpiece, kind of open. There's a difficult terrain piece in the dead center of it. There's two large Christmas walls that kind of block some line of sight, kind of center around it. The long trench pieces are running on the long side of the table board edges. So there's lots of cover. There's lots of line of sight blocking. He decides he's going to do his CAD shenanigans and put out those tokens. And two of the tokens go very close to a place where I'm going to walk in range, you know, at my first activation.
Sure,
so absolutely. So I'm like, okay, that's perfectly fine. I'm just going to go pop that bomb. That's what B1s are for.
I only have 90 wounds remaining.
Exactly. It'll be fine. Let's take this bomb out real fast. So I do. I run right into that bomb, pop. But it also means I'm within range one of the second token, which I thought, okay, that would maybe just, that's just going to be a blank
that's
one, right?
It's going to be the bluff, right?
Cat Bane. Yeah. Right. No, it no. It's CAD.
Uh-oh.
Suddenly Bane.
Yeah. So CAD Bane is now right live in front of 8 B1s, my T series. My stabs are off to the right. The only thing they can't see him right now is the tank.
I assume this goes well.
Cannot see something. That's a miracle.
Yeah, mostly a big line of sight blocking wall right there. So this is, like I said, first, second activation of the game. I'm like, oh, this is... So we start firing from the very beginning of this game. He does Cad Bane things. He's trying to live, because of course he is. He's got all the tokens now. He's got his activation tokens going to run. He's going to do some stuff. He tries to back up, but that just means I just move all the B1s slightly forward and to the left so I can see him. He's going to have some cover, but you know, he was always going to have cover. He was always going to have the tokens, like it's what's going to happen. And I know he's going to go play the card where he gets rid of his suppression on the next turn. I know that. But you know, you try to kill him. If you can kill him, you try to kill him.
Yeah,
right.
I put 9 suppression on Cad Bane by the end of the first round.
Oh.
Don't murder him. He only has, I think, 2 wounds, maybe 3. He may have 3 wounds.
Wow.
Okay. 2 or 3 wounds, something like that. No, I definitely make all the attempts, but you know, he's got danger sense. He's rolling all the extra dice now.
Yeah, because he has a bunch of dodge tokens and stuff. Yeah.
So I keep saying out loud, is it range 1 or range 2? I guess I could have asked. I can't actually see the card until he pulls it out of his hand. Right. So I kept thinking in my head, I think it's range 1 to hand off all of that suppression. It's not. It's range 2.
Oh, yeah.
So all my careful maneuvering to stay outside of range 1 so I wouldn't get it back. He's just like, no, it didn't matter at all. Blap. So
yeah, right.
Start of round 2 there. He's going to dump the stuff on me. Let me go backwards. Not quite start round 2. So that's all happening here. My stabs actually can't see him a whole lot.
Let it go, Will.
So what I end up having to do is just run the stabs to go shoot the bus, who's going to have to come at me. And because I out-activate, the tank is the last thing that goes, because it's the only token in my bag.
Yeah.
So now that the bus has now moved slightly forward, he's at range 4. Huzzah! Kablammo. So I put a healthy amount of damage into him. I don't quite kill it on round 1, but I come awfully close. He actually pulls the bus out and then hops some of his Black Sun out. That's where the stabs take care of those boys. I mean, it is just heavy fire starting at the very first round of the game. His side of the board does what I find a lot of Pike commanders tend to do, which is I'm going to buff them all up with all the tokens and sit here.
Yep. Yep. As one does.
Yep.
And I don't know. If he had gotten super aggressive, I don't know. And it could very well be wrong. He may have gotten murdered by all of my B1s. I don't think so, though. I think if he had aggressively pushed to the center, I think I'd probably end up losing this game. But I can tell you, I don't. Cad, of course, hands off all the things, which means he's locked down. Like, all my units are locked down. They have you. They can't move, which is perfectly fine. He jumps into melee, which I'm like, coolio, because I don't mind him being in melee with a B1 squad. I'll shoot everything else that's coming at me, which is those Black Hole Suns. So they're all now mostly dead. I decided to take a swinging fight. I get an extra wound in on Cad. Ha-ha! Pop him in the head. I'm a little worried because, of course, there's a bounty on my T-Series, so I do try to back him out as best I can to a place where it's going to be difficult to shoot at or cover. Like, he's not going to do it in one shot, basically.
Right.
Yeah.
My tank just keeps rolling merrily along. I've wiped most of the Black Sun except for a unit leader and their commander who's hiding behind the wall of cover. I decide I'm going to take the offensive to his side of the board because if I can wipe enough units on his intercept or his key position, he's going to feel a lot less comfortable running down the middle.
Right.
To come at me. So that's exactly what I do. Stabs do stabby things. Of course, you know, it's Pike, so they've got all the tokens. So I have to spend a lot of hits getting through the token stuff. And still only end up, I think, taking out like 1 unit extra maybe. Like, they just refuse to die, but my Pikes... My stabs are there. They're touching the things. They're just in the way. They're doing terrible things, and he's got to concentrate on killing them.
Right.
And my B1s are just whittling away, but at this point, I've rushed 2 B1s to the center point. I've got my tank who's going to shoot anything that comes towards the center. And then if I have to, I'm just going to move my tank forward and block access to the center. Like, you're not going to be able to walk around them, basically. Because, you know, a 6-inch pie plate is a pretty big pie plate.
It's a pretty big slice of pie.
Yeah,
it is.
Cad Bane never gets out. Like, he never gets to clean up the things he wants to clean up. Like, it's a couple of wounds. It's not enough wounds. He hops around to someplace else because he disengages, but it doesn't help him do anything because I just wrap up around him a second time. At one point, I was a little afraid that he was going to try to rush into melee with my T-Series just so that I then couldn't shoot him and then he would just murder my guy with full health. So I do a bubble wrap my own T-Series.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
With some B1s and shoot out from the porcupine.
Yep, absolutely. Bah, 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 bah.
I mean, he can still shoot in to kill my T-Series.
But... Sure, but you're not going to give him the lockdown for sure.
Exactly, not going to give him the lockdown. So basically, I hold that off. I mean, because we start shooting at round 1, he has 11 activations, I have 13. This is a slow game. I mean, so we get to the end of round 4, we do. And my opponent was definitely looking to see if we couldn't get to round 5 to hope to get that extra 15 minutes to maybe do a thing that gets us to the end. But, I mean, with 5 minutes remaining, I still have 6 or 7 activations, and I have things to do. It's not like I'm just going to hang out and be like, well, do I take this dodge, or do I take this standby? I mean, Will came by at about that point to see how we were at, and I didn't know. I played out, but I had lots of shots still. So by the time you do the things, line them up, take the things, roll the dice, count the things out, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you were not going slow. But
I was not going slow, so. Lots of firing, lots of shooting. So I ended up winning that game 2-1.
Nicely done.
Yes. Delightful.
Well done.
So you've been you're playing 13 activation Separatist Invasion Force, and you've been given KP twice now?
Yes.
That,
seems good.
Yeah, that seems like that time I played Double Jedi and got hostage a bunch of times.
Yes. Who keeps doing this? Please stop.
How did this happen?
He and I were tied. He and I were tied on actual points, so we rolled the die, but I was the one who managed to get that. And then we both played the same pip on turn one, and he wins that die roll, which is not what he wants. So now he has to go first, and I'm up all those activations. So
for sure.
I will say for Eric, he had some very rough bag pulls. He didn't quite have the points to get an improvise, and it caught him several times, where he pulled the token he just didn't want at the time he didn't want it.
It can happen.
I mean... That's the price to pay for independent. So.
Yeah.
The one low price.
Yeah. As someone who has no bag control and no free tokens, I feel for him.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know about no free tokens, but okay.
He doesn't get that many.
He doesn't get.
I will say he does not get 18 free dodges.
Well, that's true.
Only like
that's
two or
my
three.
My free dodges cost 100 points.
Anyways, as I said,
it was a spicy game. It didn't necessarily feel like I was going to win because Cat's in the middle of my stuff. Like he could easily grab that thing, run away. I was reserving my tank to have to turn around and shoot Cad Bane with it. Like that's the kind of thought process I have. But once he gets bogged down inside the wave of B1s, I'm like, okay, we can go take the fight to the enemy.
Your B1s will blot out the sun, like I said.
Yes, exactly.
Or just blot out the light of hope.
So Will, speaking of blotting out the light of hope,
that is a good transition.
Oh, no.
As I said,
you came
against
the Archangel Michael. How did that go?
I made those round two pairings, and I didn't see it at first, but I was just going down the list calling out where people were playing, and then I said,
yeah, you did stutter when you got
I said I said table three is me and Michael Henry. Doom was riding towards me. Yeah.
Scourge of Atlanta. So, and here's the thing. We've talked about this before. He is the nicest man possible.
He sure is.
Like,
for sure.
You can't hold a personal grudge, but he's going to take you to that woodshed, and he's going to wear you out.
Mm-hmm. He sure does.
And the best you can do is make it close.
He's too nice.
I've come very close to beating him a couple of times.
That would have been nice. But
you just took it.
Michael Henry was playing a very strong list. It was Shadow Collective as well. He had Maul with the Darksaber and, the normal push choke. Good times. He had three capos. Two had Vigilance. One couldn't afford it. 4 Pikes with capos and disruptors. And then 2 Black Sun units with just the Vigos. Which, as he pointed out, is a 66-point unit, which is 5 models, Bravery 2, free aim, free surge, Dauntless,
red
10 dice at range 2, red save.
Yeah. Seems pretty good, yeah?
Yeah, it seems pretty normal.
Yeah, seems pretty okay.
Seems pretty normal.
Seems perfectly fine.
Yeah, that entire army is Courage 2 with Maul being 3. Like, that's wild.
Yes, it is. It sure is.
Oh.
And so we end up... I did outbid him, because he was running only like a... maybe like 5 or 6 point bid, I think. Maybe a 4 point bid. But we played Intercept, Major Offensive, and Fortified. And we were on Ben's farm table with giant candle holder, whatever those are.
You know, water tower, sir.
The upgraded...
The $4 things I bought at Walmart to make water towers.
The upgraded farm table, which still includes pinwheel... pinwheel windmills. It's a nice table. But, just from setup, I had a few issues. I had kind of ended up in this kind of choke point through some terrain features. And when there's a wall of pikes waiting outside the choke point, that doesn't go well.
Nope, does not.
As Michael Henry put it very nicely, I made some deployment issues. And because of it, IG and the speeder had to sail out into the middle of the board in front of all the pikes. But, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
It survived a whole round of shooting.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah, I had a shot where he rolled, like, three crits and then impact, but I rolled all the saves out of it. Like, it was dumb for dumb. But then,
yeah,
top of the next turn, it did explode. And IG crawls out of the ruins, but I had played Mechanical Carnage. And so I was able to get to a beautiful spot where I had, like, six attacks, hitting all the pikes and both Black Sun units, just going to town. Pew, 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 pew.
You did two wounds? One wound?
One wound.
Okay, yeah.
But I killed for it. I killed seven or eight dodge tokens.
Yeah.
Yay!
That's right. You sure did, bud. Yay!
Because he was rolling great. He was rolling two or three on each shot, and Michael would just be like...
Yeah, he was.
Just like, okay, so that's two dodges on that one. Ooh. And be like, yeah. And he kept, like, all the dodges in his hand. Just like, look at all these dodges you killed, Will. I'm like, that's great, buddy. If only, like, my gun line was here to take advantage, but they're all stuck behind that barricade.
Every dodge is a teardrop.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And then after that, you know, he's just standing there looking at all these still full health pikes, like, please don't kill me. And they didn't listen. He was shot to death. You know, from there, it just keeps going downhill. He infiltrated Maul around and behind a building, so he wasn't, like, super mm-hmm. close, but he was coming around a whole different direction than in the rest of the gun line. And so I just had some fleets stand there and be like, you guys are going to hold. And they're like, no, we're not.
But... Are we, though?
But I got to use the keyword thing. Standby aim. Yeah.
Yes. Ready.
Yeah, that.
Yep.
Sure did. And we got a free shot when Maul came over the building. Yeah. I rolled my 8 white dice and got nothing. Then I aimed and got 2 more blanks. It was great. Hey. Then he started killing.
Hey,
you sure did
use those aims. Hey.
That's
almost hard to imagine at 40 points you only got one keyword.
Yeah.
Like, I'm shocked by that, sir.
It's weird, I know. They used to be 44. Anyway. That's when the killing began. Maul was choking and stabbing and whirlwinding his way through troopers, and then
yep.
Din tried to make a difference and hit him with 5 black dice that blanked out, and Maul just laughed at him and killed him. It was a whole time.
Rip.
My rebel vets are trying to, like, sneak around behind the pikes and then getting killed by capos, which is just a whole mood.
That's just embarrassing, yeah.
Yeah, it was. I mean, at that point, I'm just doing the, like, lol, let's see what it's I can get away with right now.
Yeah. Because, like, theoretically, Din might be able to trade reasonably okay with Maul. They're both got pretty sizable attack pools.
Oh, it was definitely going for the, like, just luck of the dice, blank out here sure. kind of thing. Because in one of the melees with Maul, I had, like, chipped a wound onto him. So he was like, well, if I just hit all 5 and he blanks, then maybe the game will change.
I mean, yeah. It's possible.
And he starts with a wound. So, yeah, like, he was, Shadow Collective Maul's a little easier to tackle from a big Alpha Strike standpoint.
Yeah. But
I've beaten Maul to death with some B1s. It's fine.
You sure have. But it was not meant to be. Michael was a lovely gentleman as he took me to the woodshed, as Ben said. And after his second round, Michael had 2 tablings to his name. For an even 100 MOV.
What a good time, everyone. Yay!
Yeah. Yay. I killed more than his first round opponent. I killed, like, 3 or 4 Black Suns and then, like, 2 or 3 pikes. He's like, you did something, Will. And I'm like, you don't have to do that for me, but
we don't count moral victories.
And he did come into the day knowing, like, hey, I'm getting ready, I'm gearing up for PAX.
Yeah, this was his
I'm sorry I'm about to do this. Like, there was a preemptive apology.
He was always very nice about it, just like, okay, well, yeah. I'll do this, bang. Oh wow, yeah, that worked. I'm like, you sure did, bud. Oh, they're dead. Yep, okay.
Didn't he say that he can't play this in his own local?
Yeah, he said he wouldn't use this locally since he's trying to build a community there. But he would bring it to ours.
He will bring it to ours.
But it's okay to kill your friends. It's okay.
Well,
it's
we contained him away from most of our fresh new folk.
This is true. This is very true.
By letting him just destroy me which, it's always nice to have a quick round. That's kind of not
true. Like, so David, so Michael's first round opponent, David, listens to the podcast.
Yep.
So thanks, David. Yeah. But also, he knew the danger that was coming for him.
Yeah, he knew what it was.
When
about
you announced it, David was like, "Oh,
yeah." It's like, welcome back to Legion, David. Here's Michael Henry.
So Ryan, who were you playing?
So I got to play Ashley. She's been coming out to a handful of Wednesday nights with Mitch, and I have not had the pleasure to get a game in with her yet. And she came in, it was her first tournament, and we get this cool desert table with a YT 1300 kind of like parked in a corner, and bunch of big rocks.
Sir, that's a 2400.
Yeah, don't excuse
thank
you.
Thank you. You're right.
Dash Rendar Erasure.
He lived.
She's rocking Empire, and like Mitch, who I just played, she's also got Din and IG. But this is an Imperial variety, and it's the 88 variety, backed up by three storms, a Becky, and two strikes and triple dews.
Huh.
So a very, very different kind of
I appreciate
of
this. I approve of this completely.
Yeah.
Please.
Yeah. It was a tough nut to crack for
sure.
Yeah. We're both running like triple creature trooper. I've got a bunch of emplacements. She's got some highly mobile, you know, Din nonsense. But right out of the gate, we end up on payload battle lines fortified, which I don't think is particularly good or particularly bad for either one of us. We both have creature troopers that can attack the other's carts. We've both got, you know, a few cart pushers of our own. And I throw where she has to go, is next to this big spaceship, and I manage to deploy two of my Mark IIs and my FD on top of this thing to where they are like range one away from the piece of terrain that she has to push towards. So I know I've got this huge bit of Overwatch. She splits her dues because she sees that I'm going to flank with my tawns and kind of not attack her cart right away, but try to come up around and behind. So she puts one due back there to stop me, one to kind of babysit the cart, and one to kind of hit my middle force where my cart was. And we kind of begin trading, but she scouts her scout teams a little too far forward and manages to get them killed. I got one of them round one and the other the first activation of round two. Because the way I like to play my taunts is I don't want to throw them into your red saves because they're almost always doing the ranged attack. I don't really like the ram. I would much rather have the third dodge token and like move relentless and then charge into somebody. So I've got three dodge tokens and I'm tying somebody up in a melee that I'm about to leave. Excuse me. And so my taunts are kind of flanking around back. She's pushing with her dudes, and Din is lined up to where he's got a pretty solid path of no line of sight blockers, but heavy cover all the way to my emplacement gun line. And if Din can make it there, tie these guys up in melee, it's Flamer Spear Din, so he's going to make pretty short work of them and clear the way for the bomb cart to get pressed. I do some solid shooting with my cores onto the two dewbacks that are not facing my tauntauns. I got the impact generator on my FD, and I melt two of the three dews within the first 2.5 turns. Din's taken a little bit of suppression and maybe some chip damage on the way in. I have not touched IG. I've not touched the Stormies. But the snipers are down, and my tawns are, one of them is tied up with a dewback, and the others took some wounds on the approach, but are curling around, pick up Becky, and are getting ready to chase down the cart pushers, which is exactly what I want. I made the mistake of only putting Leia, one Mark II, and one Vet to push my cart. And IG comes in and is a problem.
Yeah, come on. You should know better than that.
Well, I my defensive position to hold her off of my point was so good, I didn't want to commit, and I thought my tawns were going to be able to loop back around much faster. So she does manage to stall my cart up once, which sucks. And then when we That's kind huge, of knew yeah. IG was going to go down, IG had some pretty solid saves. she drops the IG I'm not going to die card, which normally isn't a huge deal, but on payload, it cost me a second turn of movement.
It's normally a huge deal. I don't know what you're talking about. yes, okay.
Well, the fact that like it was pretty late game and he was going to die, and there's
sure,
you know, only a handful of objectives that like being around at the end of the round really matter. It's like this and intercept. Because he had already activated, so...
Oh, I see.
I managed to kill him, but he's going to stymie the cart one more turn, which sucks.
Like if he had a box, it doesn't matter if he's dead now or later. I mean, right. Maybe if you drop
it. He's going to drop it before we score.
Right. I gotcha.
And I managed to... She gets Din in on my emplacements. I get some chip damage through. She makes the right call of instead of doing, you know, trying to pick off my two in place, my two Mark IIs, she dives into melee with the FD and just chooses not to use Pierce, which was really clever.
Yep.
To keep the FD alive.
Yep.
But sadly, the game, as we have this knockdown drag out of a game, it was incredibly tense, incredibly close, because I didn't push Leia with the card as much as I should have. I wanted to get a good CB shot off, which meant she wasn't contributing to pushing the card for two turns. On the last two turns of the game, I had to be a bit of a scumbag, and I sandwiched my last three Rebel vets that were pushing the card in between the bomb cart and a piece of terrain to make them do back charge proof. There was no where, since he can't overlap the objective token, there's no way for him to basically charge. They're going to get heavy cover, and that Dewback gun with four whites is probably not going to pick up three Rebel troopers in heavy cover. So we do some weird positional stuff. I managed to get IG down. I managed to get my last remaining two Tauntauns over to her cart to stop hers. And we have the dumbest Din fight I've ever seen. And I managed with the FD cannon's melee gun to put three wounds onto Din across two turns. And killing Din puts me over in kill points because I did get IG. And our bomb carts, this is how much of a bloody game it was. Both of our carts were range two away from our zones. So we did not do a very good job of pushing our carts and like both bumping or both. And they were almost identical distances apart. Mine was a little bit closer as just the table side for payload favored me a little bit. But we were both range two away. It came down to kill points and it was a super, super, super close game. Ashley was a fun opponent. She played great. We've already got a rematch on the books, I think. So it was a really fun time. And
I will say, coming into a tournament situation, mm-hmm. like sometimes these are the hard games that do fry your brain for round three.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you realize around three, like, you know what? I'm done. My brain, I'm out. Like, we've talked about this many times where we played games. We're just like, well, then I didn't know what to do. So the game was over and I was like, I'm just going to go have dinner. Like, I'm out. Like,
I think the direct quote was, going into the turn six, I think I'm going to throw up.
That's fine. Happens.
Yeah,
I've been there.
That means you're in a good spot.
That's fine.
Means you're in a great spot.
For sure. It was a super tight game. And if you're only been out on a Wednesday night where everything is kind of, you know, casual and free flowing and there's not a clock ticking and it's a super tight game, that's games on Saturdays hit different than Wednesdays.
And they do. They do.
It's a different environment.
I talked with Chad about quite a bit.
I'm going to fully.
That's nice.
I'm going to fully admit something to my own shame as I transition us into the social medias. So I was bringing more things into the store Saturday morning. I've met an old friend of ours who I haven't seen in ages. Jason Cole was there to pick up some Warhammer things. I told him it was the wrong game, but he says, I play too much Star Wars now. I need some other IP in my life.
Interesting. That's a different excuse than he used with me, but continue on, because I told him the same thing a few months ago.
Okay. You know, for a long time, he was like, I'm in architecture school. I don't have time for this. And then he was like, well, I'm spending a lot of money woodworking. I'm like, buddy, those are your habits, not mine. But anyhow, so he and I have a great conversation, but I get distracted. I leave my phone in the car. Ooh. Which I know doesn't seem like a big deal, but we don't get to park down because there's so many of us on that day. I'm parked up a hillside, up a very rickety flight of stairs. It used to be Will's mortal enemy. I play till time. I don't have a lot of time to run up to the car, grab my phone, and come back. I took no photos. And I felt so bad about it. Because, and I kept saying, man, I wish I had my phone. Man, I wish I had my phone. Because we had such great tables. We had great paint jobs. Like, it looked beautiful. Cinematic moments that were absolutely going to happen. I took none of those. So, you still want to check us out on the Instagram, look at us at STABcast, where photos will be coming. Will likes to post his paints. You can always accidentally find Daisy's Instagram while you're there. I'll try to post some things from the other day, which I haven't posted. I just felt so bad because the tables look great. The armies look great, and I just didn't get any photos. I felt real bad about it.
I have a like photo from above of all the tables, so I'll try to get that on the Instagram.
You do?
But
yeah, and I know several of our other players put photos, and we can scrape them from the event page and the Facebook group.
Steal them from the Facebook group, yeah.
Absolutely.
Well,
you post a lot of photos of the Wednesday night games. We'll just steal those and claim them to be
right. No one will know.
No one will know.
Apart from us.
But you check us out at STABcast on the Instagram.
Be sure to also check us out on the Facebook or the Twitter, if you want. And then give us a rating on your listening. If Twitter still exists.
Otherwise,
Otherwise, we'll create a Tumblr. and then please
scrub a couple accounts before I can do that.
No one understands our pain. Tumblr, yay.
And please give us a rating on your platform.
That is kind of our brand at STABcast, so yeah.
Yeah. We are the Tumblr kid of Legion podcasts.
Oh, man, it's so true.
Oh, that's so sad. Okay.
Well, I never thought about it that way, but you are correct.
Well, if you'd like to talk to us, please. We're on the Legion Discord as well, where you can tag us at STABcast, whatever.
My Chemical Romance.
I think I'm STABcast North now. All those good times.
Yeah.
Listen, I've had some great conversations in the Legion Discord over the past couple of weeks.
Then you got told to leave.
I got told to leave. It wasn't a holiday. You get to come back soon.
I've been unfortunately busy. Normally I'm a little more active in there, but I've just been so busy. I've not had a chance to sit down and scroll and have a good time.
It moves so quickly, and there are so many of them.
You say that every time.
I'm just glued to my phone. But unless I'm glued to my phone, I find, I step in at a conversation, which I know it's like a bar. You show up, you shout things, you have a good conversation for about 40 minutes, and then you leave again.
That's why Discord's great.
I have a hard time doing that. I want to be involved in all the or aware of all the conversations.
So, for example, in the last 2 hours, there have been 62 messages in Rebel Chat because that was the last time I looked at it.
Good.
In 2 hours, because we've been recording this podcast. I haven't been patrolling the Legion Discord, but I'm just saying that's 62 messages. So if I'm working in my day job like I do, I'm gone 12 hours. There'll be 1,000 messages in a group.
I'm pretty sure they hit 10,000 recently. So that's impressive.
If you don't want to be old men that complain about things on the internet like me and Ben, you can go to our shirt shop, go to teespring.com/store/STABcast and get a fashionable young hip kids hoodie, I guess. I don't know. We're gonna try to sell to Gen Z now. Or you can send us an email at swstabcast@gmail.com about what you guys want. Show ideas, critiques, bad lists for Ben to not play, / maybe sometimes play.
Or good lists for Ben to play, and we'll see what happens.
Or whatever.
Listen, or whatever you want. Jan and I came up with exactly the same idea, and we felt delightful. I've enjoyed it so far. So
it's true.
In 2 rounds, I've enjoyed it.
So you can also find us at our booking appearances at various conventions.
Yeah,
that don't pay us to be at.
Book
we
signings.
Just want to go to anyway.
Yes, that's right.
So we got a bunch of fun events coming up. Tim, you're going to PAX Unplugged next weekend.
I
sadly couldn't make it.
I am. I'm very excited. As we discussed already, working on this list, getting it refined down. Tomorrow, which by the time you'll hear this, when this drops, will be 2 days from now, or 2 days from then, and it'll be
2 days
then,
ago.
And then was then, and now is now, and that was
when
then.
Will then be now?
Later.
Now
but anyway.
Is now.
Time is a square
circle.
Exactly. It's more of a timey, wibbly, wibbly, wobbly thing. But anyway, yes, so I'll get to go to PAX. I'm very excited for that. Looking forward
it's
to
like
going channel. To Philly. Unfortunately, I don't have a whole lot of time because of a new job, so I'm just going to be there, like, pull in Friday night, driving in, play Saturday. Once I lose, like, I don't know, probably explore a little bit on Sunday and then leave Sunday evening so I can get home in time for work on Monday. So I normally like to have an extra day, but I don't have an extra day this time around, but it's okay. And I will say, too, PAX Unplugged is the first major event to be using the new game uplink that is from our friends over at 5th Trooper and 6UP Supply that teamed up to make a
doing another ad read.
I am. It's a fabulous new tournament organizing software that was... It is made for Legion right now, but it's clearly going to be designed to, include other games down the road. For anyone who used TTO or any other maybe softwares that are still around, This is
Longshanks.
It's so good. I wasn't going to say Longshanks. I wasn't going to shit on them, but I will.
I love Longshanks. Because
it's garbage. No.
The hell?
I like Longshanks.
That's okay.
It's not the pirate system, which I hate.
Yeah, yeah. It's not Best Coast.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe that's maybe I'm getting them.
We can
confused.
Shit on Best
maybe
Coast.
Maybe I'm getting them confused. Yeah.
You're confused.
But yeah, so Game of Life is super smooth. It's like they count your timers in there. You can put all your information. No more match slips. It's great. Records all that information on there automatically. Obviously your timers. It will put in your winners automatically, so it calculates all that SOS, extended SOS. It's super smooth.
If Jake's paying you for this, you know you have to share with us, right?
It's super smooth.
I'm sorry, sir. Really, you've run over on your time to plug anything Fifth Trooper related.
It's multiple people related, though. That's the great thing. It's made by Legion for Legion. So there you go.
Yeah.
It's community.
I would tell you, until it gets more use, make sure that you go to the Fifth Trooper website to click on the link to it. It is just gameuplink.com.
Yeah.
But if you Google, you may run into a couple of things you didn't mean to find.
Yeah. Yes, yes. Gameuplink.com. So there you go. Yeah, just, exactly, yeah.
If you're not careful, you may accidentally... Because I just typed GameUplink into Google.
Oh, no.
Definitely...
No, no, that's not it.
Don't do that. No. That'll take you to an adult website if you're not careful.
No, GameUplink.com. And then you hit beta.
And if you put the space between game and uplink, it takes you to a hacker video game from 2001.
But,
hell so, yeah.
All that to,
all until
that
the
to
Google
say,
recognizes the glory that is this system.
Yes. All that to say, if you want to follow the results of PAX, right now there's 61 people signed up on GameUplink. So it should be a good size event for sure. And you can follow along there and see who wins what and who beats me and how they beat me and with what list. So it's great.
Tim's excited for the odd number. He might get a buy.
That's true. I have a chance of a win. Hooray. And then also, the next weekend will be Everwinter in Boston, which is also close to me. That one, I don't know why I did this, but I'm flying into that one. I think because I found a cheap enough flight. But unfortunately, I might not be able to go now because... Just behind the curtain, peek behind the curtain. Just, I don't know who's going to watch the dogs. Long story short. So if I don't have someone to watch the dogs, my people that was going to watch the dog, namely my wife, fell through. So we'll see. We'll see. She was going to be here. Now she's not. So it's okay.
Listen, you just let Nala and Maya out. You just let them just roam the countryside. It'd be fine. Oh, they'll be there when you come back.
God, Maya would.
I mean, you do now live in the farm upstate. Yeah. So.
Like Maya would actually come back. Maya would like wander around for a minute and be like, "Ah, this is scary. I don't like this. I'm an inside dog. I'm coming back inside." Nala would just sprint.
Also, there are businesses that watch dogs for people.
That's more of an expense.
That requires money.
And I'm inviting a stranger into my house. I don't like that. I don't like that. My home is my castle.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah, after that in January there's going to be this little tournament called the Las Vegas Open in Vegas. Should be a decent time. Me and Tim are planning to be there.
Yes, I will be there.
It's gonna be great. I have to be there. I just put the finishing touches. Hopefully by the time you're listening to this, the player packet for the doubles event will be uploaded on the Legion Discord, and it's gonna be nonsense, and I'm very excited for all you players to come and play the insanity that is my doubles event.
I'm looking forward to seeing whatever paint graphics you've created for the
oh, yep, they're going to be awful.
Oh god. I didn't think about that.
Oh no.
I created a lot of the original pieces, which I have the Photoshop, PSDs for, but I did not see any. Ask for help on that one. So I'm looking forward to see whatever paint nonsense comes our way.
Oh dear.
Oh, it's literally my deployment zones are just like a table that I colored the cells onto.
Yes. Oh, good.
To give you the ranges.
Good.
So, yep.
Yes.
It's going to be a great time.
Speaking of a great time, Cherokee.
Woo!
In February.
And we are just like month to month to month.
Yeah.
This is great.
Check out Frontline Gaming for the tickets. I know I've got mine and my hotel booked. I'm looking forward to it. So, it was a great time last year. Yeah. There'll be no Tim, so that's a plus.
Well, I might be there. If I can find a cheap enough flight, I'm good for it. But I'm not driving down for that. Sorry.
Well, no.
No.
It's a bit of a
way. The hardship with flying into there is you have to go Knoxville, you go Asheville.
I honestly...
And so getting
or Greenville.
From you to there...
Or Charlotte.
Yeah.
No, Charlotte's too far.
Charlotte's
4 hours away.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no, you rent a car.
Yeah.
But it's the only big one nearby.
I'm aiming for Asheville, most likely, for flights, because it's a little...
You could also do Atlanta and come up the back way.
Or I could just not go.
True.
I mean, that's all of our preference, but no. The cool thing I'm excited for about Cherokee is there's going to be a convention exclusive mat. If you've ever come to any place, we've brought tables and played on my crate table. I had a buddy of mine make that mat. And Frontline is going to be printing copies. You can pre-order it. It's for pickup there only. It's not going to be sold anywhere else. It's going to be stamped with the Cherokee 23 logo. And as far as I'm aware right now, that's going to be the only place to ever get that mat. There'll be a couple of them in the Frontline Gaming kit. There are going to be a couple of them at LVO. But if you want one of your for yourself, it's the only place to get it. So it's going to be pretty cool. And Frontline is not taking any cut off of it. Anything that we're going to sell the mats, and all of that money is going to go into the Legion prize support. So if you guys want to help make the tournament bigger and better, go buy a cool convention.
In related news, STABcast is starting a charity fund called Legion Prize Support. Now, there's no need to be concerned, but it's fine. Everything is fine. Everything's above board.
Listen, the board of executives are well compensated for the time they have to put
it's
in true. To maintain.
It's hard work, but we do it for you, the community.
The listener.
You know, I will say I kind of miss the exclusive mats that FFG used to
The ones for X-Wing were nice.
I mean,
yeah.
Because I could always kind of track my years of playing because I have a mat from
That's true. That's a very 15, inconvenient 15. Way to track playing, but yes, it's true.
It is. I was there. I remember that tournament.
Speaking of remembering tournaments, there was once upon a time this thing called Adepticon. And so once again, we will have Adepticon. And March 23rd to the 26th. And this is important, folks. This is newly, I shouldn't say announced, but newly clarified as far as the exact dates. Newly announced and clarified is there is a last chance qualifier for Legion and other games too, but for Legion on Thursday. So what is that?
Or the World's competition.
That would be the 23rd, correct? I didn't double check those dates. I just want to double check before I lie to someone. Yes, 23rd. So on the 23rd is a last chance qualifier for Legion. So if you did not get your Worlds ticket handed down to you because your friends helped you do that, but not really.
Because Tim Hot diced me and I didn't get the invite.
That's right. And Ryan constantly makes fun of me because of how the system works, so that's okay.
Anyway, oh, I hot diced Henry, it's fine.
That's right. you did. Just on that one roll, but yes. That was the roll heard around the world. That's true. That roll was so bad that COVID happened. But anyway. It was the last event before COVID. I'm just saying.
It was the last
invite handed out. But yes, so Adepticon will be a grand old time. I've actually never been, so I'm excited to go. I didn't get into the host hotel because I was working and I didn't pay attention.
Nobody ever does.
Yeah, I know.
So I assume it's mostly vendors get that one.
Yeah, I'll be across the parking lot, but I'll walk over. It's okay in March.
No, Adepticon's awesome.
But yes, so it'll be a good time. So I'm looking forward to flying in. If I can't get a flight from PAX, then I will fly in. But we'll see. See if I can either win one or more likely win one by random luck in the draw from PAX. Because they're doing two random flight vouchers.
It's given possible.
Out. Yes, exactly. It's like playing the lottery.
It's possible.
Yeah.
But anyway, tickets will go live on December 16th. So keep your eyes open for that.
Soon?
Yes, very soon. Very soon.
And while the World Championships are cool and all that, the best convention of the year is the Rocky Top Game Con here in Knoxville. Memorial Day weekend, 27th and 28th, we're having a Legion tournament. Here it's our hometown event. We went from 12 players 2 years ago to selling 64 tickets. I think we had 52 players show up, and we're hoping to fill again at 64. I'm waiting to hear what organized play plans for next season after Adepticon look like. I don't know if they're going to keep the same model or not. We have no news on that. I would like to hope that we've proven to be a big enough staple event that, depending on what organized play form it takes, we'll have some kind of support from AMG. If not, it's going to be a great time. We're going to have a table competition like we did last year. It's a fun little convention that's growing, and Beer Castle, which lots of people have messaged me that like
I missed
going out to Schultzbrau afterwards was the highlight of the event.
Absolutely.
So Schultzbrau's my place. I miss it very much. I will say that.
So yeah, you guys should definitely, tickets are on sale for Rocky Top Game Con right now. You can go get them. I know we've already sold some. So if you are that much of a forward thinker and planner, start that turn zero and get your tickets, and we'll be excited to have you guys down here.
You know, we often talk about tournaments in the South. We don't seem to have enough of them. That's but, you true. Know, you can go to the Ruckus at Rodia, the Bayou yeah. Wars in Biloxi, Mississippi, June 10th and 11th. Now, I tend not to go south in the summertime because I'm from there and I remember what that feels like. But if you don't mind sweating with the masses.
If you want to melt in the swamp.
I mean,
but Biloxi's yes. not too far from Houston. It's not far from New Orleans. You can still get up there from the panhandle yeah. of Florida. If you are in the South area, Biloxi's not far from a lot of places, to be honest. No, my sister's from Biloxi. I don't hold it against her much, but she is. That's what
it's like an doing. Hour from New Orleans. So that's yeah. probably if you're looking to travel down to it, that's probably the way to go.
But it's being hosted by a good friend of the podcast, Cammy. So like they're, yep. you know, they do great work down there. So if you get out to Ruckus at Rodia, you should go. Because they're actually really great people to play against. Had a lot of fun with them. We were at New Orleans last year about yeah. this timeline. So yeah.
Good. Yeah, I'm looking to go. In the past, it's collided with Atlantic City.
Right.
But to maybe change things up, we'll see if I want to go back to New Jersey or, you know, back home to New Orleans. We'll see what happens.
I mean,
but I really do hope to make it this year.
Man, that is 6 months of events.
Yeah, yeah, it really is.
We're missing April and just April, I guess.
April, yeah. I don't know if we have official dates yet, but April is traditionally the Dallas Open that those yeah. guys put on down
That's
there.
That's true. That's true.
So,
but yeah, if we can get in April, then we'd have a full run through June.
For sure.
And we haven't even talked about West Coasty things. I mean, this is all just...
Yeah, well, it's because we don't care.
Not yet.
West Coast yet. Doesn't count.
I mean, I guess LVO is theoretically West Coast.
Yeah, it's West Coast.
West-ish.
Now, they get world's invites at tournaments with 18 people. I'm not salty.
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine.
Oh, man.
Rocky Top's
man, oh, man.
Uh-huh. Well, you know what there is this week?
The news.
The news. It's back. News.
So much news.
There's two things of news.
My God.
Oh, there's actually two?
Well, sort of.
Yeah, there's actually two things of news.
The oracles say that the points will be handed down to us from above in December.
The comment,
so there's news about news.
There's news about the news happening.
Comment, the AMG comment on a X-Wing comment.
On an X-Wing Facebook post?
Yes. I think.
Yeah, because Legion doesn't get those.
No, but it was someone asking about Legion in an X-Wing post. And
well, and
yeah, we'll see.
It's one of those...
I'm pretty sure
guys,
X-Wing...
I understand it comes down to money, why you can't hire a social media manager. I get it.
Well, except I think they have
this
one.
Is exactly why you should probably... I mean, they have, one, Ben. But
okay. They do.
Do they?
Yeah.
I mean, I guess that's true. I mean,
otherwise, no one
it's
would...
It's Daisy.
Old man shouts at clouds. Rah!
Rah!
But no, I mean, but...
I hate them cloud.
We talk about it in such a way like I cannot understand go the cloud, to a place I don't to find trust a centralized it. Location where someone says a thing.
I think they do that on the like, Discord.
That's and the website too. the website's also centralized now. Like they updated the website.
They did upgrade the website. Actually, we'll
say, the website.
I
is
do
much
love
nicer.
How every time I we've do. Talked about the internet with Ben this episode, it's just been okay, boomer.
A little.
So the thing is that no, you're all so him. Wrong about this. I don't know why. You know, used to have centralized organization of our, so it was a unified message from corporations, but we don't do that now. It's just randomly scattered about the winds. And maybe it's because you can't hold anybody to it. Maybe that's why we do this.
That's exactly
that's right.
I didn't say it out loud
these
on my
damn
website.
Damn standards keep changing.
It.
We can't hold people to them. I'll tell you what.
All right.
No, not holding the standards, Tim, is holding me to information that I said once.
All right, well...
There's no proof okay, if buddy. It exists on Facebook.
One might say that you want to burn this down with fire, so let's talk about actually burning
yes.
it down with fire.
Hey. Yeah, Boba has a projection issue. Someone asked if you were going to be a daimyo. Get over yourself. But
you survived a Sarlacc. It doesn't make you daimyo
but,
material.
But new old Boba gets a new flame projector that's not like the old flame projector, except it is with a little difference because it's new
but
and
better.
Old.
But it's literally better.
Yes. Instead yes. of a command card, what if it was a 5-point gear upgrade?
So much where it should be.
That, it's, yes. expendable. It's expendable.
It is. It is yes, like Din's expendable. Yep. Range one or melee, one red die per yep. per model due to spray, yep. and suppressive just for good measure. But clocking in at 5 points, and yeah. I believe Tim, you said the arsenal does work if you play the
yes.
two pip flamer, so you could
yes.
it does.
Double
so you
red
can either,
flame.
You could double flame one target or two for flame two different targets if they're at range one or engaged.
If you're at range one of two B1 units and just want to watch everything burn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seven red here, eight red there. They're all dead.
Well, so of course, so that's what, of course, what everyone's talking about, right? Is like, oh, you can double flame. Cool, cool, cool. Which is true. Absolutely true.
Yeah.
But I also think it opens up another command card slot for you if you're running Boba with other characters that have cards.
I don't think you need to double flame.
Right, right, right. Like, if you're running just Boba, then sure, that's fine. But if you're running other things where you might want to take a 2-pip, then you can be like, okay, well, I don't feel as bad about losing out on
flame
card because I still have a flame card. Not only that, it's a somewhat timing neutral card. Like, I just use it when I feel like it. I don't have to worry about
it. You just have it. It's not like only during this round or whatever.
Yeah. Well, hell, you can still, technically, you could play Ambush and still get a flamethrower off. So there you go.
Boom, right, done. Yeah.
Yeah. So I dig it. 5 points.
It is very good.
Feels like where it should be. Sorry that Din's is more expensive. Whatever.
He's a rebel character. He's
probably a slightly better platform. That's at least debatable. When I'm from Rebels.
That's fair.
Because he's speed three.
If you're doing Rebel Rebel Boba, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's fair. Yeah, that's fair.
Speed three. But Empire Boba can still take this, so enjoy.
Yep.
Oh yeah. Empire Boba is riding high. We're good.
Yep.
I didn't think about that. That's
it's just Boba Fett. Right. Boba Fett.
No, sir. Don't care for that at all.
So
that concludes the news. Thank you.
Yeah.
That's all right. I believe I have faith. I have faith in the G that we will have news by the next time we post. Next episode that we record, whenever that is. Which I think would be good Christmas, so we'll probably have to change it. But I believe we're not in December yet. Maybe
our next episode will come out on December 14th. So maybe we'll have.
You know what? I take that back. I don't believe. I changed that completely. Yeah. I forgot what day.
Yeah,
it is.
Yeah.
Probably.
Probably. Yeah. Actually,
you're probably wrong. Yeah.
Of course, that being said, just a little highlight of what's to come. We'll probably record our Christmas episode sometime here soon.
Yeah.
Because we'll all be traveling with holidays and times just to make sure y'all have your Life Day event. I'm not sure if we're going to wrap up the Clone Wars or go back to the Caravan of Courage. I'm not real sure which holiday.
Yeah, we'll find some.
Watch the Guardians of the Galaxy holiday special. There you go.
That I heard it's good. I haven't watched it.
I have. It's true. It's supposedly good.
For the NPC podcast that we're becoming.
No, we've held off this episode so long because you guys actually had content to talk
sometimes
about.
Sometimes when Ryan's talking, I play Marvel Snap. It's pretty fun, actually. You know,
that is a good game. I'm not going to lie.
It is actually pretty good. It's pretty solid.
So to bring it back to the tournament.
Yes. Let's finish
round
this thing.
Round three.
The
finals.
I had a very eventful round three. We did have one player drop after round two. So in my role as tournament organizer, I also dropped since I was still recovering from what Michael Henry had done to me. So I did drop at 1-1. You know, got to spectate round three, talk to Walt about prize support, do the important tournament organizer things. And spectate some sweaty games. Because going into round four...
So at this point, there are, four undefeateds?
Yeah,
is that right?
Yeah, going into round three, we had four undefeateds. Yeah. Ryan, Ben, Michael Henry, and Chris Vandergriff. Two Shadow Collective in there. So, weird.
Yep.
I've played Ryan recently.
Yep.
We always have a tight game. It's always... It's so I think, okay, I could fight Ryan here. I could fight Michael Henry, which I did not like my chances for.
No.
Nope. My list has activations. It does, but I'm never going to get through all the pieces. And I know it's going to be a rough game. I'm going to make it the best of it. I know it's going to be a rough game. If I came out on top, it would be partially a Thanksgiving miracle. And so I'm like, I kind of am hoping for Chris Vandergriff. It's been probably 2.5 years since I played Chris. It was pre-COVID. I played down in Chattanooga against him.
Right.
Like it was so long ago we were playing bombs. Like saboteurs were the thing at the time.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's how long ago it was. I see Vandergriff all the time at events, but he and I have not paired up in a long, long time.
And so I generated the pairings. Yes. And Ben, who did you face?
I faced Chris Vandergriff.
Wow.
Now, to his credit, you're marked for death. Good luck on that, buddy.
Good luck.
now Vandergriff had his own Stabcast gauntlet he was trying to accomplish. That he had beaten everybody else. He had not beaten me.
Sure.
Those two, the couple games I played against him, I have taken the wins every time. I do often get paired up against his son, Hayden, which, you know, being but a youth.
You are the scourge of children.
I have a scourge of children. So. the teacher in me comes out, and they're like, oh, God. And then I just dominate. Just bah, bah, show them how to learn. So, anyhow, but Chris is playing another form of degeneracy, another Shadow Collective. And it's honestly, it is quite gross. It is two Pike Syndicate capos with Vigilance, a Pike capo with Improvised. It is Maul with Darksaber Choke, Push, Vigilance, Tenacity. It is five Pikes with Disruptors and Capos, and a single Naked Pike Squad. Okay. So it is six core, all full except for the one Naked.
Yeah.
There are more Capos than there are core units. Like, is that three and five? There's eight? I mean, there's eight Capos floating around this table. It's a lot of eight. It's a lot of, lot of stuff going on. Like, it's just so incredibly gross. So, and I know what's about to happen. He's going to have all the tokens. I'm going to try to shoot through them with white dice that even with a single aim isn't going to do me a lot of good. He's going to block any crits that I have come up with those dodge tokens. Like, I know this is not a great fight going into it. We're playing on the Jungle Gungan Shrine table, which I do thoroughly love. There's actually a terrain piece that I had moved to be off the center, and Chris thanked me for that, because often when he sees that table, it's been a table that's been floating around for a while. It's one we got from Dan Wolf several years ago. So it's just in the Atlanta, Chattanooga area. And I moved it so it was not the centerpiece, and he thanked me for that, because often it is. It's a good piece, but it can be a fight in the center because of a kind of a tightly enclosed ruin. I am blue player this time, but not because I had the bid, because Chris gave it to me.
Ooh.
He wanted to be able to pull a table side.
That's fair.
And we end up with an interesting flop, and it becomes Intercept, Fortified, and Disarray. Now, I've already said why I did Disarray, but looking at our list, like, this could go bad for both of us, actually, because it's Intercept. It's one of those places where things can just get a little nutsy here. So we put the pieces out. I do have more activations, so I am able to spend a little bit more time. I mean, man, not much more, but I still, you know, I think he's got 11. Was that 5? 8, yeah, 9. Yeah, something like that. 10. So I've got the spaces to go last, and so I hold off as long as I can. And I see that since we're playing Disarray on his right-hand side, his close side, he is putting almost everybody he's got. He's got Maul over there. He's got most of the Pikes. He sends to the one side the Kappa with Improvise because he knows it's less likely to die early because he'll have Improvise longer. And, you know, the Naked Pike Squad and then one of the full Pike Squads to go take his left-hand side. So this allows me some time, and I actually drop the tank real early to make sure I don't actually run over my own boys, because once I see where Maul's going, that's where I'm putting the tank. I'm going to try to sink as many shots into Maul as fast as I can while I can. This means, though, that I can, because of the magic of STABs, put the STABs and two B1s on my far right-hand side across the table. And my plan is I'm going to run down that side, take that intercept point, leaving my two B1s, and then swoop back around with the STABs to clean up the middle to fight the right if I have to. The middle is always going to be rough for both him and I because we've got so many forces on my left, his right. We're going to fight mostly over that, and whatever spare units can be spared are going to run towards the center. This game gets real spicy real, real quick. Tank pops out. I use it immediately because I can able to make that chain work for me. I sink some shots into Maul. I think I get him at 3 health, which doesn't seem like a lot, but, you know, that's not bad. Maul blocks like 70% of the rolls there. So, I mean, that's not really good for him. But that puts him at 3 wounds very, very, very early. So Maul's going to have to do some bouncing and some shredding. And, like, I'm just trying to stay out, but every time I shoot into something, he's wiping out B1 units. It just gets ugly. I do the best I can to hold, but, you know, it's intercept. Like, you have to go to the point at the end of round 2. So, yeah. And he's got better gun lines than I do. He's going to end up with more. I mean, I've got some fortified positions. I'm going to take some heavy cover where I can. But if I move close, Maul's just going to grab him and start choking B1s because that's exactly what he does. I would think that with 3 STABs and 2 sets of B1s, I should be able to clean up my right-hand side pretty easy. That's not true, because Pikes being Pikes, with a cap over there, just have all the tokens, because I didn't get any orders. And so it takes me nearly 3 rounds to clear up that entire side, which was tight. I mean, it just took me, like, you throw the dice. I had good dice, and I didn't have bad dice. But between the things they can block, between having the suppression and giving them the stuff, like, they just block a lot more of it. So it takes me three rounds to clean up the right-hand side. On the left, Maul dances in, does exactly what he does. He force pushes, he chokes some guys, he's wiping out units left and right. He's just trying to find it, get down to the little bit here. There's a little bit of a freak out because Maul takes a little bit more wounds than he would like, so he ends up taking down, you know, he gets the four wounds there, so I'm only two away. I'm trying to murder him. He's got to play witch magic a little earlier than I think he likes. I'm trying to blow up some pikes, and I just cannot do it. And so he and I realize scoring's about to happen, and so I am able to put out a unit to get to the center before he can. He falls a little short of the first scoring round, so it is 2-1. We keep fighting. Now, like I said, and I'm running out of bodies at this point. Like at this point, I'm right. Actually under activations to him, which is a very scary place to be.
For sure.
I do manage to tie up Maul decently well because the tank, he tries a couple shots on the tank. I think I'm at three wounds by the end of the game. Like that doesn't do a whole lot. So kind of probably wasted shots there. But he also knows he just can't afford to let my tank just roll forward and shoot things. Because if I can, I'm going to just roll forward to shoot at the center point as we start trying to tie that piece up. At some point, I've got a three-man unit tied up into the pikes right next to the intercept point. Like, I'm trying to not get shot. And so he tries to punch me in the head, and they fail. Just blanks. Which means my guys live. Because, you know, they're B1s. They're not going to block anything. Right. They live. So he's like, oh, that's real bad. Because that means there's an extra body there, which means I can contest, which just forces him to stay in the center because he can't get over there. And so, again, it's just a pounding. We're both trying to put it out there. The pikes live longer, but... like I said earlier in the episode, pike guys tend to sit in place and not move a lot.
Yep.
I manage, once I clear the right-hand side, I start running a B1 body across from my right to the center. I've run three B1 bodies across from my left to center, trying to just put unit leaders over there. They're taking a beating. At some point, I go up with my T-Series to just shoot Maul in the face if I can. Because that's how desperate it's becoming to me. Like, that's how tight the things are going. And again, we've been shooting since round one. We were gung-ho from the very start. So we're fighting this thing out. We're getting close to time here. Mm-hmm. And Chris realizes that if this doesn't happen right now, I'm going to have enough bodies to tie up the center. I mean, I'm going to get my side. He's going to get his side, but because I'm up a single point from the previous,
sure,
I'm going to end up taking this game. And so Maul has got to do some stuff. My staps run across the center. I blow up a unit where I can. I mean, I'm just throwing dice. I'm long range bombing, try to kill off Maul, and I do. So that's a great place to be there. Now, he's still going to take that left point, but you know, Maul's going to drop dead here, which means he can't run to the center and really disrupt but just by force pulling. He can't pull my units out of there.
Right.
And so because of that, we get down to the very, very end. The dice, like I said, for him, twice failed him, but all of his defenses were more than magnificent. His attack dice got him in places where if he could just clean up an extra unit, if he just moved a little bit farther, he might have had that center point. But we have, I think, four units on the center, and we are tied. Like, that is how close we are for intercept. And so that makes me win 5-4.
Well done.
I pull it out at the very end. He does not get his Stabcast gauntlet. He falls. And I have had, it was a tight game. Oh, I really, like, I thought I've been losing since the beginning. And I had just managed to hang on by my teeth and nails. Just hang on there.
That's what Intercept does.
Yeah.
What Intercept does.
Having 87.5 wounds seems pretty solid way to play Intercept.
So, you know, we're talking this up at the very end, like what goes on here, what goes differently. And I told him honestly, right, Nothing goes differently. He does exactly everything he had done because I think I won just because of a lucky blank out on his part. So he can't wipe a unit, which frees him up to move some more. And I think Maul dies at a place where if he just survived one more round, or if he could have killed one more unit with Maul at that point, that just would have helped him. But I had enough activations, enough bodies, enough blocks to, you know, to do a thing. So, of course, Pierce doesn't matter with Maul against B1s because they weren't blocking anyway. But
for sure.
I lived just a moment too long. Because I'll be honest, if we weren't on a timer, if we were going to play all six, I lose that game in a heartbeat. I just don't have the ability to clean up and do the things. I lose B1s. Like the next two rounds get played, or three rounds. Or no, we got through round four, got started round five. So if the rest of that game plays out, it just goes terribly. I mean, it just, yeah. But I win.
All right.
Nicely done. I win. Hold on. 3-0 on the day.
Yep. Which is nice. Nice way to end my gameplay for this year, because I'm not playing more games between now and Christmas.
That's probably true.
You never know. It could be a Christmas miracle.
I mean,
you never know.
I don't think I am either. It's okay.
Oh, it's okay.
So, Ryan, you drew Michael Henry.
Yeah, I drew the final boss. We already talked a bit about his list. We're playing on... I got the home field advantage where we get put on crate, and... Man, we flop over to breakthrough battle lines, fortified positions. And I put fortified in my deck kind of because I didn't know what I really wanted my fourth condition to be. And in hindsight, I really, really need to make this hostile. Hostile. I was a little worried about like my courage one core getting pinned down and Leia's only courage two. But I really need to throw a hostile in there just for the Shadow Collective
but
edge.
But do they care? Because they have capos on everything.
The capos can panic themselves if they're not careful.
Yeah, it slows down aid to where they're taking all the suppression from that. And when we're playing an objective like Breakthrough, it can deny them actions. Yeah, they're not dying, but it can make it that much harder for them to get a second action to move across the board while I got taunts. So, and that was one of the things me and Michael Henry talked about. But we set up, he does a really passive deployment behind the Imperial bunker that's on there, to where he only really gets to be seen if he wants to be. He puts all of the capos and all of the pikes kind of balled together, with the pikes looking over the left side of the building, and Maul, he infiltrates on the right side of the building, so to kind of make sure that I can't crash my taunts into the capos, because that's obviously 100% what I want to do, because my gun line is so much worse than his until I get the dodge engine down. Once the dodge engine kind of gets stymied up, then I can start to trade. And he hangs his two Black Sun way out on the wings, just to kind of, A, there's not a lot of ways for me to pressure them, that way they can run across the board and play Breakthrough, and B, they can zone out one of my taunts. I put one taunt over there early just to kind of try to bait some activations over there. And then I put my other two on the other side because I wanted to sacrifice one taunt to the Black Sun and make sure my other two got as far away from his Black Sun as possible. Turn opens, and I want to say it was the first activation. I had deployed one of my Mark IIs in a pretty rough spot, but he was going to have to move out so he wouldn't get an aim token, take a range three shot into this Mark II that I had put far forward and one shot it. But I was one move away from getting into a pretty well entrenched, heavy cover on three sides, piece of terrain that if I could just pull a core token, which I have six of in my bag, pull the core token out, activate the guy, move the Mark II and stand by, he's going to be in a great position to watch the center of the table. But an unaimed shot, first activation, kills my Mark II at range three. So I'm already down. I've lost my activation lead, which Taunts really, really like. And my Taunts don't have a lot to do turn one. We do a little bit of trading. I think I get one model on turn one as I kind of slowly take my position and he takes his. I know we both realize it's going to be a really cagey game of Breakthrough, where it's basically going to be my Taunts, his two Black Sun are going to make a run for it. And can my Taunts either do enough damage to disrupt him enough to where my core can dash across, because I do have no time for sorrows, which really helps, or just keep my Taunts alive, which is also going to be an endeavor in and of itself. And I put shot after shot after shot into the pike gun line, because that's all my gun line has line of sight on, because of the big Imperial bunker. And I think it's turn three, I finally clear a unit of pikes. Two of my taunts are being stymied up by Maul. One of them, by the time they crashed in, there was only one mini, and the stupid capos kept making saves.
Yeah, my taunts, hang on a second. At this point, didn't Michael Henry tell you this was the first unit he'd lost all day?
Yeah, I was getting to that. But yeah, Michael Henry, when I pull off a full squad of pikes, he looks at me and he's like, well, you've done better now than everyone else. I haven't lost a unit leader all day.
The problem, though, is he then Michael Jordan that and took it personally.
Yeah, he did. So we continue to kind of trade. I cannot get any damage to stick. And granted, it's one anomaly for another anomaly. I get that. But all day, my Tawns had not rolled a single blank red attack die up into this game. And up into this game, probably half of my die pools had a blank, whether they were two or four red dice. It was absolutely absurd. Trying to chip my Tawn damage through, which most of them at this point are on just one mini each as Maul kind of chases them around. But Michael has made no play for to play breakthrough other than his two Black Sun. I catch one of them and get a great three wound shot into. Maul kind of for a minute tries to poke out. My FD cannon catches him. And the way my trenches were set up, I had my FD cannon on a higher piece of terrain. And we did not treat the trenches as area. So since I could see his full base, I catch Maul out in the open, put like three wounds on him to put him up to four. So he's in danger zone. But which magic happens, he heals three during the command phase. I do it again. I put like two more damage on him. Leia turn five makes the push with some troopers. She's been slowly kind of creeping up, but makes the double move. No Time for Sorrows push where I'm just trying to get as many bodies over the line as I can. Maul comes and engages her and just whiffs on the attack. Absolutely whiffs. He's still got her tied up, so Leia's no longer going to be able to score. I've got one Tauntaun unit leader left, but he's probably not long for this world. I've managed to get one of my vets to where he's going to score. He's got his two Black Sun, but they came back to sink some shots into some of my core. So there's a chance. If Leia can CB, she's currently tied up with Maul, but if Leia can CB these two Black Sun, there's a chance that I'm going to get two across. He'll only get one, and I'll win the game. He's way ahead on kill points. Leia manages to karate chop Maul for 3 for 3 into two blanks and kill Maul, which is huge. She moves, steps up, takes the shot, gets the two hits she needs for the CB. He rolls blank surge, but because he's got the capo there, he's got the surge token on standby and manages to live, uses Dauntless to get back into the breakthrough zone, and we tie 2-2. It was a knockdown dragout game, but it was definitely Michael taking this really great defensive position and me having to try to crack it and just not being able to trade in that gunfight, despite all my critical, all my range, the little bit, I think I've got better range four with the CMOs and the FD. But all the crit doesn't matter when you've got all the dodge tokens without maneuver. I just couldn't crack it. And, I don't feel too terribly bad about the way I played to play Michael to a tie on VPs. Obviously I lost by like a million on kill points. But that's how this list has to play into that gun line, is you got to sacrifice a lot of pieces. It was a super close game. It was super tight. I thought I was the first two turns, I was just going to get shot off the table. He was rolling saves left, right, and center. Some of my attack dice were pretty good too, but the amount of dodge tokens he could generate just didn't matter to where I fell to 2-1, but still had a great time playing with Michael's always a blast. So cannot complain. Appreciate Will putting on the tournament and me not having to run things. It was great. Well done, sir.
Yeah, it was a good time.
Since MOV is the thing that was going to get us there, I was never going to beat Michael Henry's MOV.
No.
He had two 100% games the first one.
He sure did.
Yep. And all of mine were close. Mine were 2-1s.
I did my darndest, buddy. I did my darndest.
Mines were all 2-1s and those kind of pieces. So yeah, it wasn't likely going to be a thing.
But you came second. And then
yeah, you finished second.
Nathan Morgan, yeah, third place. Ryan, beast. Fourth. It was a good
tell
time.
You that Nathan Morgan, I miss playing him because he was that sneaky good. He would get it there and be like, I'm gonna surprise you with this crazy list that's gonna
put
actually
in a,
kick your
put
ass.
In a solid 2-1 with his separatist list.
Yep, that's fair. That's fair. Respectable.
Who ended up beating him? Like I never did see it, so
was it the Henry?
No.
No, it was
You know, if you had game uplink pulled up, you could be able to look it up very easily on the game uplink.
I'm looking at it.
The fifth trooper and the sixth the day before the supply.
I was about to tell you until you went off about that. He lost to Will Werner in the first round.
Nice.
They were tied on victory points. Tied victory points, and Will beat him by.
New community organizers out here.
Will beat him by 18 kill points.
Shoo.
458 to 440.
Sad beige kill points for sad beige children.
Jesus.
I mean, yes. Yep, that's, you know,
that's fair.
Just almost half a squad of B1 points.
Jesus.
I hate it.
But you know, it was
a
life. Thank you, Will. We had lots of fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm sad I missed it. So good times. Good times.
Handed out some of the limited edition Grogu's, including a time when I was trying to give it to last place who stayed for the day, you know, like Scott.
Yeah, you tried to give that thing
Scott,
away, man.
You did. Scott went 0-3 and stayed all day. You know, I try to reward those that
good
don't
for
drop.
Him. Good for him. Yeah.
And so I tried to give out this Grogu, and Scott's like, oh, I already have one, or didn't want it. So I went to the next up. They already had one. Next up, already
they
had
already
one.
Had one.
Just like, ended up standing there. Said, well, somebody take this baby. ended up giving it to like 10th place.
I was going
to
get a Grogu,
no.
But it turns out no. I was like,
no.
Second place doesn't get a Grogu.
No,
nope.
Luckily, we'll Michael Henry's like, I don't want one, so I'll pass it down to you.
Yeah, nobody wanted these Grogu miniatures that Walt was excited to give away. It's like, sorry, bud.
They're
It's very cool that Walt was giving them away.
Yeah.
This is why I love our community is everybody that passed on them. It's not that nobody wanted them;
they already had them.
It's that they already had them. And so, like, the fact that we've got this awesome, friendly community that's not going to hoard an eBay stuff.
Right.
We want to make sure that prizes get into the hands of people that they're going to use. And it's not just us, but that's just our community in whole.
Yeah, I'm joking that it's nobody wanted it. It's just that it was hard to find someone who didn't already have one.
You were trying to, like Oliver Twist, you were trying to sell that boy and no one was buying. So
it's true. Not even sell. Give away. They'd already paid $10.
And when we make an Oliver Twist reference that's relevant, it's time to end the show. We've been here far too long.
We're over the 2 hours.
We're over the 2 hours. It's
true.
Yeah, by the time you cut this down, we probably still
are. Oh, yeah.
So thanks, everybody, for spending your drive time, your paint time, whenever it is you bother to listen to us. We certainly do appreciate it. And until next time, I'm Ryan Slawoski, reminding you, Michael Henry, that my off-meta nonsense is coming. It's coming for you.
I'm Will Heim, reminding you to try out MCP. It's a great game system, and I haven't talked about it enough this episode. Great models, great things coming out. I think we're getting Rhino soon, Ben. Rhino. More Spider Foes.
I do love a Rhino.
Yeah.
Rhino's fun.
And maybe an Electro. That'd be awesome. Marvel Crisis Protocol. And then Shatterpoints. Get in.
Hey, they are going to actually have demos of that coming up at Adepticon.
They are. They're going to have demos at Adepticon. You can sign up for them, maybe.
There you go.
You know these reminders are supposed to be like short and pithy, right?
No.
Yeah, well. Well, I'm Tim Hannon reminding you.
We'll have to do the editing.
I'm the producer now.
Of course,
he can speak as long as he wants.
That's fair.
Well, I'm Tim Hannon reminding you that the 5th Trooper special over under PAX Unplugged Edition featuring yours truly is on their YouTube channel. Published 2 days ago. But I'm on it, so we are represented.
You can just join them if you need to. It's okay.
No, we are represented. I'm just saying.
See, this is probably not the right place to talk about this, but Tim will get silent sometimes. We say, hey, what you got going on? And he's like, I may possibly be recording a podcast with some other people about another thing. I was dipping my toes into appearance. I'm like, buddy, we can't even promote it.
Listen. Over Under was a mix of multiple podcasts. It was me.
We still had no idea what was happening.
Or your side piece, Tim.
We're his side piece. You know,
Everyone's a main piece until someone has to, you know, go somewhere else. It's okay. That's fine.
You know, he sends us a Snapchat every now and then, but
burner phones are made for
your first marriage that established you into this community. You had to marry up into this.
Used us to launch yourself.
Now that you had what you want, exactly.
Upward momentum.
Our minimal clout.
there is a term for this. It's called positive attrition, but that's okay. Anyway, it's a true thing.
Ben, remind them of something so we can leave.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you that I have played games, and I have come very close to winning tournaments, and 3-0 is not bad. Second place.
His quarterly legion has been had. Tune in a few months to hear how Cherokee went.
Exactly. Which I'm actually helping run, so I'm not even going to
play.
Sad. It'd
be fine. Good
night,
everyone.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
There it is.
There's the music. Yeah. Right.
On the 110th episode of the STABcast, we can expect battle reports.
It was you.
I know. Yes, that's... I was in the middle of it. Now you cut me off. Now I gotta go again.
The Ron Burgundy effect has begun.
We can't interrupt him. Who put that on the teleprompter?
I was already looking at
There's a
screen.
Reason why we record this in four tracks, so we can edit anything out that we want to. You just keep talking.
I was looking at Amazon already. It's fine.
I know. You've already disengaged from the episode.
And we're a minute in.